download the Kayak app today and go see for yourself.
It's our 50th birthday, and the one and only Double Big Mac is back at McDonald's. Hang on, I know the moves to this one. Make space! McDonald's 50th birthday! You're all invited! Until 3rd of September, from 11 a.m, participating restaurants only, subject to availability.
Aldi's flying the flag for fresh with the latest Super 6 fruit and veg offers. This week, spring onions just 49p, sweet corn 69p, white mushrooms 89p, all British, plus sweet pointed peppers 89p, pink lady apples only 169, and regal vine tomatoes just 119. That lot'll take some beating. Aldi, Team GB's number one fan.
It's the totally immersive football experience.
Right, put it on!
EFL Live on Talksport 2.
In the 80s, they won Wembley silverware and established themselves in the top flight. But the majority of the intervening years have been spent down the divisions and even in non-league, with more games against Histon and Lewis than Liverpool and Arsenal. Now, after 25 years, Oxford United are back in the second tier and back with a bang. But tonight is a night that could provide an excellent barometer of what lies ahead.
There goes the full-time whistle. Joy for Oxford United. Tie a yellow ribbon round the playoff trophy, because Oxford United are championship now for the first time in a generation.
Then that is the big one, but you know, I believe that we can you know, have a really good year.
Mark Harris making it a golden return to the second tier for Oxford.
Once players were able to see what we were trying to do, it built and built and built all the way to Wembley, and we've started to really see that now in post-season, pre-season and the start of the season.
Wright's in space inside the area. Hadji Wright! It's in! Went through Sarkic! What a turnaround! At the Coventry Building Society Arena.
I'm excited because we're building. It's the start of a journey for us.
It's Hadji Wright gets to the byline. Head out across the face of goal and in. It seems he's done it again.
We're facing an opponent who are on the up. You know, they've got the tails up, and I think that it will be a really exciting game. I think there's almost a full house tomorrow, and what's not to like?
Live on Talksport 2.
And live on Talksport 2.
Good evening from Jim Proudfoot in the West Midlands. Oxford's first away game at this level since 1999 comes against the Coventry side, who came within inches of an FA Cup final last season. Form which has given the Sky Blues hope that their 24-year wait for a return to the elite is approaching its end. And they make their seasonal bow at the CBS Arena with two players making home debuts, keeper Oliver Dovin and midfielder Jack Radoni. And there are two more summer signings on the bench. All told, Mark Robbins makes three changes to the team that lost to Stoke on the opening day. Laddie Baudier, Eccles and Wright come in for Thomas, Allen and Mason Clark, who all dropped to the bench. Four of the side started the League Cup win at Bristol City on Tuesday. Oxford have named the same team that beat Norwich on the opening day, so it's eight changes from midweek. Tyler Goodrum makes his 100th appearance for the club. New boy Matt Phillips is scoring the League Cup on his debuts on the bench, as is Dane Scarlett, who signed this week on loan from Spurs. So these are the teams in full. Coventry have Dovin in goal, Fanay White, Laddie Baudier, Binks and Bidwell, Radoni, Eccles and Torp, and a front three of Sakamoto, Sims and Wright. Cumming is in goal for Oxford, a back four of Long, Moore, Brown and Bennett. Vaux anchors the midfield behind Goodrum, Rodriguez, Branigan and Poeta, with Harris up front. And former Sheffield United women's striker Courtney Sweetman-Kirk is alongside me here in the Midlands tonight. Great to see you, Courtney. What constitutes par for Coventry this season? What has to happen for this campaign to be regarded as a success?
I think, again, it's got to be playoffs. And sometimes you look at it maybe a little bit and think, Mark Robbins, he keeps consistently overachieving. But when you do that, there's then the expectation. So, but then when you look at the squad, they've added a little bit. Year on year, unfortunately for them, they've lost O'Hare. They lose players like Gustavo Harmer. They lose players like Jokeres. But they seem to then still live on. They rejig it. And again, that's down to how well Mark Robbins does with this team and as a manager, and why he's one of the longest serving in EFL. So I think they've got to get playoffs. I need to see more from Ellis Sims. We saw it the back end of the season. Same with Hadji Wright. And I think Victor Torp as well, seeing a bit more from him. You know, the back end of last season, coming to Coventry was very good, but you've got to see more goals from him because the way he can strike a ball is incredible.
Well, it's been some start for Oxford. They comprehensively beat Norwich last weekend before following up with a routine League Cup win against Peterborough. They started as favourites for relegation this season. How would you plead a case for them defying those odds? If they're going to stay up, how are they going to do it?
I think sticking to their principles. I was listening to Des Buckingham and I really like the way he speaks about the game, about his team, and he was talking about that trust, how they play the game, wanting to still play the way that they want to play, and that means being on the front foot, being aggressive, but there's that adaptation. And I was listening to him when he spoke about the playoff final at Bolton, and he was saying earlier in the season they played like they normally play, and he thought that they went in the press too early and they got caught out. So they didn't necessarily go into a low block, but they went into a little bit of a mid block and they adapted. And I think they're going to have to do that this season. They want to stick to their principles, but they can't be too stubborn. So I think they've got a very good manager at the helm that will adapt them into this league as much as possible. Obviously, it's going to be difficult, but they've got some very good players. And I like Cam Brannigan a lot, by the way. He's a very good player.
And we'll hear again from Des in a moment. But first of all, we kick off fast approaching. Let's get the latest odds with William Hill.
In the zone on Talksport 2 with William Hill. Prepare for greatness with William Hill. 18+, gamblerware.org.
And Lee Phelps joins us to discuss the latest odds. Lee, good evening to you. Let's start with that relegation market. Are Oxford still favourites for the drop after their good start?
Marginal second favourites in Plymouth. Now the favourites at 6-4, but there's not a lot on it. Oxford United are 13-8. Then you got Cardiff 11-4. Same price. Preston Derby at 3-1. I know you can't say anything after one game, can you? But I thought there was some really encouraging signs there. And you listened to Courtney then talking about kind of sticking to the principles. I think it's doable if you get off to a decent start. Obviously, the cup win in the week as well. They've, 1-2, both 2-0, not conceded yet. Scoring a couple of goals in each game, so confidence will start to flow, won't it? And I think if you can manage to keep that flowing through the first five or six games, then we might see those relegation prices getting bigger and bigger. They're 9-2, incidentally, to finish in the top half, Oxford.
OK. What about tonight's game, then? How are Hill's pricing that one up?
Yeah, well, Coventry are odds on favourites to win this one, 13-20. The draw is priced up at 3-1. Oxford are 9-2. Anyone who's heard me on here before talking about championship teams at odds on will know I'm not going to like Coventry. I mean, I just don't think they haven't showed me anything this season that makes me want to back them at that sort of price. And the home form in the running last season was obviously really poor. You know, I like that momentum coming into a season, and I think Oxford have probably got more momentum than Coventry have. I'm not saying that Oxford are the bet at 9-2. I was tempted, though, I must admit, but the draw at 3-1, I think is a decent enough price, to be honest with you. If you put in there both teams to score, I think both teams will score. So a score draw, any score draw, is priced up at 4-1. Don't mind that at all. And obviously we've got all the goal scorer markets as well. Ellis Sim, brilliant last season, of course, in the Cups. 9-2 to score first and 6-4 to score at any time. And then the two main players, I think, that you're looking at for Oxford, Mark Harris at 27-10 to score at any time. You know, and Courtney's just talked about Cam Brannigan. Completely agree. And when I saw this price for Brannigan to score at any time in this game, 6-1, I couldn't believe it. He scored in the first game. I think he's a fantastic talent. And I think it's 6-1, just to score in the game, is my favourite bet of that one. Just a quick mention for the Premier League, of course, as well, over on Talksport. A big game, Man United Fulham. And the Man United players, of course, are not ready for this, as the manager said. So it would be interesting to see how they come out. But they're 6-10 minute, 16-5 the price for the draw. And Fulham are priced up at 9-2. All the bet builders available on that one. There's a free bet builder that you can claim as well on the match. And there's a flash odds, which is Fernandes, Rashford and Smith Rowe to all have a shot on target each. That's priced up at 9-2, enhanced from 5-2. You can bet up to £20 on that one. So they're all the odds and offers on the app and at williamhill.com.
OK, Lee, thanks very much indeed. That was today's odds update with William Hill. Get epic value all season with William Hill. 18+. BeGamblerWare.org.
In the zone on TalkSport 2 with William Hill. Prepare for greatness with William Hill. 18+. GamblerWare.org.
Well, it has been some journey for Oxford United boss Des Buckingham since his arrival at the club last November. And ahead of tonight's game, he's been reflecting on his time in the job so far.
I spoke when I, maybe after a month or two of coming in, I think when you come in the season, you don't have the pre-season, you come in relatively as an unknown, you know, and you've come in following what Liam Manning had done. Liam was very good with the group, and I think it was a bit of a surprise, this group. I spoke about, it kind of felt like you're a bit of a stepdad stepping into a family, and anyone that's, you know, I've had that experience of that. I think anyone, but now, the back end of the season, you almost got it the way you want it. Players start to really understand, and it took time, but when it clicked, it did feel like it's not yours, it's ours, but it come good. And I think once players were able to see what we were trying to do, it built and built and built all the way to Wembley, and we've started to really see that now in post-season, pre-season and the start of the season.
Courtney, Sweetman-Kirk here in Coventry tonight. He speaks so well, Des, and I know a lot of people are desperate for him to succeed. What's your gut feeling? Is this going to be a successful season for Oxford if success is a 21st place finish?
Yeah, I think they can. Obviously, I think especially for a team coming up in that squad depth, it's always about keeping key players fit. So if they can do that, have a bit of luck on their side. As I mentioned earlier, I think the fact that he has his processes and the way his team wants to play, but also he's not too ashamed to be adaptable and almost play horses for courses against different teams. Yes, don't get me wrong, in terms of Norwich, for example. We know they're a team that aren't in a good place, but in terms of how, for example, they negated the threats of Josh Sargent, it's signs in the middle. I think it was a very intelligent performance and a tactical performance from their manager as well. So I do think, given the rub of the green, they will have a successful season and stay in the Championship.
Well, the two sets of players will be out very shortly. A quick word before kick-off on three significant Championship transfers today. Starting with the man who's the division's leading scorer last season, Sammy Smodix, leaving Blackburn for Ipswich in a £9 million deal.
Yeah, can't fault him, and I think he's had a fantastic season. I said this last week when I was at Ewell Park. I've still got my reservations in terms of a big fee for him, because doing that at the top level in the Premier League after one really, really good season, I'm not sure. I hope he proves me wrong, but I don't think he's got the consistency of background to be, you know, a 15, £20 million fee, for example, if he'd done that for three seasons, let's say.
Another move that went through today was slightly more under the radar. There hadn't been too much speculation about Wilson Honorbed at Tottenham, but a £25 million deal.
It's a big fee for a young player. I think he's got a lot of quality. And last season, when I saw him come a little bit more central towards the back end of the season, I liked it a lot more. I think he has more influence in the play, and there was the times where he did get a little bit isolated out on the wing. So certainly, if we see him centrally, I'd be quite excited to see what he does in a Spurs shirt.
The other significant Championship transfer today, Tommy Conway, leaving Bristol City. That had been expected. Middlesbrough is his destination.
Yeah, and I think not a better manager to go to. Tuber Akpom spoke about Michael Carrick and the confidence that he gives players. So another young player going to a manager that will give him confidence, and I'm excited to see what he does it in a Borough shirt.
Well, the two sets of players are out here, and a big flag was raised across the Coventry fans on the far side. We'll live and die in these towns with a Coventry City, or the city of Coventry skyscape behind it. That aligned to a song by The Enemy, a Coventry band themselves. It is a sea of sky blue, with the exception of the travelling support away to our right-hand side. They've got half the stand away to our right-hand side, and Oxford have probably brought, I would guess, about 1,200, 1,500, something like that. Plenty of yellow shirts away to the right-hand side as they look to maintain what at the moment is a perfect start to the season. Let's remind you of the two teams. Courtney, give us your thoughts on these two 11s as we go through them. Firstly, Coventry, Doven in goal. Fane White, Laddie Baudier, Binks and Bidwell, Rodoni Eccles and Torp, Sakamoto, Sims and Wright.
Former centre-forward, I always look at that in Ellis Sims. The fact that he scored in the week, got his account open early on, so I think that's going to be vital for him. And as I mentioned, Victor Torp as well is a player come at the, you know, in January and the back end of the season looked fantastic, so I'm looking for him to really push on and have a really good full season in a sky blue shirt.
Jamie coming in goal for Oxford, then in front of him Long, Moore, Brown and Bennett and Volks, Goodrum, Rodriguez, Branigan and Guajeta with Harris up front.
Yeah, Volks, he's got the experience, isn't he? But Cam Branigan, for me, fantastic player, great from long range. We saw that against Norwich, but just likes to run the show. He's brave. He likes to get on the ball in the half turn, get in the pockets. So what's vital for Oxford United, not just tonight, but for the full season that he is on, he's firing at full cylinders, because if he is, he makes that team tick.
The benches for Coventry, De Silva, Thomas, Allen and Mason Clark. Kitching, Thomas Asante, Palmer, Andrews and Wilson for Oxford. McEachran, Phillips, Ebuay, Sibley, Almazouni, Lee, Kioso, Dane Scarlett, who signed this week from Tottenham. And the substitute goalkeeper is Matt Ingram. Referee David Coote, who only took charge of three championship games last season, but he's the man in the middle tonight. Two clubs on the up after enduring some of the darkest days. Oxford's best finish in a quarter of a century is guaranteed. Coventry hope for their best in 24 years, and that could be the passport to a return to the Premier League. With the men here in the cup back in January, the Sky Blues blew Oxford away. What's tonight going to bring? Here on TalkSport 2. We're underway. Oxford yellow shirts, very dark blue shorts. They kick from left to right. And Coventry, the Sky Blues in their traditional sky blue shirts and white shorts. And the ball goes through to the Oxford United goalkeeper, Jamie Cumming. And they'll play out from the back into the feet of Cam Brannigan, who briskly worked it to Joe Bennett, but passed him. And he goes out of play for a throw that'll be taken over on the Coventry right-hand side. Great atmosphere here for the seasonal bow, the first home game of the season for Cov. First two matches they played both on the road, at Stoke in the league, and then a much better performance and victory at Bristol City in the League Cup the other night, which has earned a tie against Oxford in the next round. So this is the first of two meetings between these two clubs in 10 or 11 days. Bidwell bringing it forward here for Coventry. And then the feeder had you right around the edge of the penalty area. Back from him to Eccles. Van Aewijk into the figure of Radoni. And now out towards Sakamoto. Missed the back end of last season through injury. A great turn by Sakamoto. Stands the ball up towards Bidwell at the far post, just over him. He's gone to ground after a little coming together with Goodrum. But the referee says play on. There were no complaints actually from Bidwell. And play goes on, but that was Sakamoto at his best. Then, that wasn't, but he's got away with it. He's got a free kick 15 yards outside the area. Trying to control the ball with his right foot, it hit his left leg, and it deceived him and the defender who dived in and fouled it.
That's always the worst one, when you don't know what you're doing, neither does the defender, but the initial one down that right-hand side, I think it was absolutely fantastic. Sent for a little hot dog, I think it was Bennett on the other side that he deceived, gets the ball in. And it's a shame that Bidwell doesn't time his run quite right to meet the ball, but it's a bit of a firecracker, isn't he, Sakamoto?
That was a wonderful piece of play. And it's given an opportunity here for a free kick, which is going to be taken by Coventry. And it's Eccles that is going to leave it for Victor Torp. Torp in his white boots. Tall midfielder who made a real impression having signed in the transfer window back in January. What's he going to be able to do from here? It's 30 yards out. Right foot, he's gone for goal. It's gone innocuously wide. Got the ball over the wall. You'd expect that from that distance without a problem. But then it bounced innocuously on the edge of the six-yard box and just trundled wide for a goal kick.
Yeah, he certainly didn't catch it right. I can't remember what game it was, but it was here at the CBS. I saw him crack one in from about 30 yards. I don't think I've seen a ball hit that hard for a very long time, so his technique on the ball when he gets it right is very, very good, but certainly wasn't what he wanted there.
It was a game against Sheffield Wednesday. I've got it written down. I didn't know off the top of my head, but just looked down at my notes. I'm trying to get one up on you. It was an FA Cup game against Wednesday that he scored that goal. Here's Sakamoto bringing him forward again. It's going to be knocked away by Will Box just outside his own penalty area, and a free kick, and then just a little coming together on the edge of the penalty area involving Brannigan and Sakamoto. Brannigan just giving Sakamoto a shove. And it's going to be a free kick going to be taken by Oxford, but only after Cam Brannigan is spoken to by the referee. No yellow card. But he's just going to go over and have a little word with the assistant referee. They're happy. And play will resume with this free kick, which will be taken by Oxford just outside their own penalty area. 4 minutes gone here on TalkSport 2. Coventry 0, Oxford 0. Choice of live listening for you tonight, remember, over on TalkSport right now. Manchester United against Fulham in the curtain raiser for the Premier League. Here, Coventry 0, Oxford 0. It's Courtney Sweetman-Kirk.
Yeah, and I've been really impressed by the start that Coventry have had, almost playing Oxford at their own game. That high press, really aggressive, not letting them breathe for a moment. And again, making the pressure so they turn over the ball in the midfield.
Now, Hadji Wright brings it forward, but only after being judged to have pushed Sam Long to the ground. And it's a free kick that'll be taken by Oxford in their right-back position.
I think Long gets away with one there. I think it's more of a coming together than anything. And we know once Hadji Wright gets the ball at his feet like that and the space in front of him to drive into, it's a very dangerous game to play for Oxford United.
Oxford launch a long ball forward out to the left-hand side. It's controlled by Puejeta, another one of the summer signings. He played in the championship last season for both Norwich and Swansea. And now the ball goes back to Kieran Brown. Brown launching it, left-footed, giving Mark Harris something to chase. Ball played back to the goalkeeper, and Coventry able to knock it away with Dovin, but he asked a fair bit of Lati Baudière there, and it's gone out for a throw that will be taken on the Oxford left-hand side. Five gone, 0-0 here on TalkSport 2. First real chance for Oxford to be able to get the ball forward. And it's going to be a throw. Will Vaux has got a long throw, a really good long throw on him. It's the cue for Brown to make his way forward. Elliot Moore is forward as well. The Coventry defence trying to keep an eye on him. It's Binks that's watching Moore. Moore just comes away outside the six-yard box and making a run out from the near post area. He's obviously got a guilty look on his face. The referee's just immediately gone and had a word with him. It's just the way that he sort of vacated the scene as if he'd been sprung and knew that he'd been caught for some misdemeanour. Still waiting for the opportunity for Vaux to launch this long throw in. He gets it towards the near post. It's half cleared and then knocked away before Puejeta was going to be able to pull the trigger. Wright will chase after the loose ball. The vastly experienced Joe Bennett can mop up on the edge of his own half of the centre circle. And Cam Brannigan will play it back for Bennett. And Oxford go all the way back for their goalkeeper, Jamie Cumming, who signed permanently over the summer after a loan move from Chelsea last year, where he really caught the eye. Now, coming into this, Oxford's defensive record's been really good. They didn't concede in that playoff final. They haven't conceded a goal so far this season either. And defensively, and it is by and large the same defence that played last year, they've been sound. Here's Long, the Oxford-born right-back, playing for his hometown club. Coventry win the ball back with Eccles. Eccles to Lati Baudière, and then Binks back to his goalkeeper. Dovin, the Swedish international, making his home debut tonight after his summer move from Hammarby. Lati Baudière hooks the ball clear. Sakamoto helping it on. And here's Jack Radoni, the summer signing from Huddersfield, making his way forward towards the edge of the Oxford penalty area. Six back behind the ball for them. Cross comes in, a left-footed in-swinger that's easily headed away by Long.
Yeah, and it's not a bad idea, but I'm just looking at Ellis Sims and Hadji Wright. They're on the same line. They've got to be a bit better with their runs. They're a bit more clever. Because as soon as the ball doesn't go to one of them, that's it. No one else can pick them up because they're on the same line, so they need to work on different lines.
Binks to Bidwell. Back for Eccles. Josh Eccles, more than 100 games for Coventry behind him, playing it forward here. Turned by Radoni to Bidwell and straight back again. And now Radoni, wearing five but playing in central midfield, can play up Victor Torp. Torp just losing out, and here's an opportunity for Oxford to bring it forward on the counter-attack. Goodrum with a good ball for Puejeta, making a run from the left wing down into a central channel. Binks saw that his goalkeeper came out to try and deal with it. He sensed that the ball might not have the legs to get there, so he took responsibility. Coventry work it from back to front pretty quickly, and Radoni's got plenty of space to work. Sakamoto to his right, right inside the penalty area, trying a shot which is blocked, and Oxford can get it away. Not for long. Bidwell picking it up. There was a foul by Eccles, and Brannigan wins the free kick.
I think Radoni in the middle of the park for Coventry City, he's had a fantastic start to the game, full of energy. And I like the fact that he's always on the half turn. He wants to play forward. There was a little incident just in front of us where he does the same thing. Doesn't quite come to anything, but yet again, driving into the space. And Oxford, they need to be careful on the transition because they're getting caught out, outnumbered, and then they're just dropping further and inviting the play by Coventry City, and they get away with one there.
Elliot Moore working it forward to Volks. Now play back for Kieran Brown. And the Northern Ireland international goes towards halfway. Oxford more than happy just to play one-touch football, working it from back to front and then forward again quickly. Long ball over the top from Volks was overhit for the run from Goodrum, who's making his 100th appearance for Oxford tonight at the age of just 21. Coventry win it back and get it forward down the right-hand side. Van Ewijk, the Dutchman, only able to present it to Bennett, the opposite fullback. Long ball over the top from Brannigan, and Goodrum can chest it down. The angle pretty tight right inside of the penalty area, but can he cut back inside? Went the other way, got a right-footed shot in. It was blocked by Bidwell. That was excellent play. Des Buckingham loving what he saw there, except for the finish. It's blocked and goes out of play for a throw. 10 gone, 0-0.
Yeah, brilliant from Brannigan, and that's what I was talking about before the game. He really can run the show. His technical ability on the ball is second to none. And it's just a shame there for Goodrum, because when he brings it down on his chest, it takes him out wide. If he chests it to his left-hand side towards the goal, he takes the defender out and will have a better shot on target.
In comes the cross from Binks, the header from Puerta, and comfortably dealt with by Dovin, who just for a moment was looking nervously to his left-hand side, but it didn't have the power or the accuracy even to really significantly trouble him. And he can pick it up comfortably. So 0-0 here. It's 0-0 as well at Old Trafford. They're about 30 seconds behind us in that game between Manchester United and Fulham. We'll keep you updated here. But if you've got the TalkSport app, you can easily swipe left and swipe right and keep up to date with both games as they go on. Radoni spinning one over the top here. Adji Wright making the run. Long will get there first. Clears, but not effectively. Only towards Radoni. Radoni to Bidwell and back for Jack Radoni again. Coming in off the left-hand touchline. He's taking on Goodrum. Goodrum able to stay goal side for now. So Radoni, with his floppy blonde hair, able to peel away. Bidwell then fires it in. Sakamoto brings it down. Left-footed shot is blocked. He'll scurry out of the penalty area and get to the loose ball first. Now finds himself faced up by Puerta. Lovely drop of the shoulder and then a pirouette, and it took two to stop him. And they did so, but at the expense of a corner.
Yeah, the ground erupts, and rightly so. He's one of those players, Sakamoto. As soon as he gets on the ball, everyone's excited. Everyone just starts to lift off their seats a little bit. The way that he twists and turns, it's unbelievable, and does well for his team there. But on the other side of that, Long, that clearance, it's really poor. He's either got to hit it against Hadji Wright, or he's just got to go, does neither there, and puts his team into trouble.
So Radoni's going to go out and take this corner. Sims standing right in front of the goalkeeper. Bidwell on the edge of the six-yard box. Four more in sky blue, making runs from the far post area. Radoni swinging, actually, to the edge of the penalty area for Victor Torp. Right-footed shot from him. Referee defended that well, of which more in a moment. And then Bennett, coming out of the penalty area, is judged to have been caught by Radoni, and there didn't seem to be an awful lot in that. It's a really well-worked corner. Four at the far post, all making runs, drawing Oxford players towards the edge of the six-yard box. Space for Victor Torp on the edge of the penalty area. The referee's got to stand somewhere, but he wasn't aware of exactly how the corner was going to go, and he made a movement towards Torp, which, if anything, stopped him getting a first-time volley in on goal.
Yeah, and it's not ideal. These set pieces are so well worked. Mark Robbins and his staff will have, you know, worked all of pre-season to try and work an opportunity like that. And as you say, it's unfortunate for the referee to get in the way. But what I will say as well, Goodrum was switched on, and he made sure, yes, the referee helped him, but he got out to Torp straight away to try and negate that threat.
And Goodrum makes his way down the Oxford right-hand side now, wins a throw, which Sam Long will take. Harris leading the line for Oxford in this 4-1-4-1 formation, making a run across the edge of the penalty area, taking sky blue defenders with him. Try to work it back in towards Long, but missed him. And then Radoni, right in front of the referee, goes down. No foul, says the referee. Play on. And Ruben Rodriguez went down as well. I think the referee would have given a free kick for that had Oxford not had good possession. They've worked it out of the left-hand touchline for Bennett. Now it's played forward by Brown. And will bounce two or three times and go trouble-free into the Coventry penalty area, where Dovin will pick it up and bowl it out for Louis Binks to bring it forward again. Good start, good tempo, albeit really, Courtney, in the opening 14 minutes. Neither goalkeeper's had anything to do yet.
No, it's all been in the middle of the park. It's been quite transitional. So for For the neutrals around watching, or listening rather, you know, it's fantastic because it's exciting, it's high tempo. But I think when you look at it either side, both managers will be a little bit upset that their team hasn't held on to it and been a little bit more composed on the ball.
Binks goes long, looking for Sakamoto. Bennett heads it away, but Fanny White picks it up. Now on the edge of the penalty area, Sakamoto with a good disguised ball in. There's the header from Hadji White. 1-0 Coventry. What a start to their home campaign. Inevitably, Sakamoto involved, stands the ball up, and Hadji Wright with the most powerful header. It's only about 5 yards out, and he's booked it past Cumming to give the Sky Blues the lead.
What I really like about this from Hadji Wright is he's under pressure. It's not just the fact that he's 5 yards out and he's just got to head it in the back of the net. It's his desire to get above the defender, to be strong and say, look, the ball's coming in the box. This is my ball. It's a fantastic delivery from the right-hand side, by the way. But the desire to get to the ball is what I really like about that goal, Jim.
19 goals for Hadji Wright last season, including 8 in his last 14 games. And his 20th goal for the club is the first on this ground this season. Sakamoto for Van Aewijk, and Wright showed magnificent desire to be able to get there and give Coventry City the lead. Well, this stage, when the two sides met in the cup here last season, it was already 3-1 to Coventry. Had just the one meaningful attempt on target tonight, but it counts. And Hadji Wright has put Coventry into the lead here. And the ball over on the right-hand side for Cov again. Van Aewijk to Radoni. Sakamoto coming in off the touchline. And he was caught by a combination of Bennett and Puerheta. And Bennett then kicks the ball away and gets a yellow card for it.
Silly, that is. We're just about to tick into the 17th minute. And to get yourself cautioned so early on in the game, kicking away a ball and then you're walking a tightrope. But that right-hand side for Coventry City at the moment is definitely where all the danger is coming from. The fact that the full-back's joining with Sakamoto, there's fantastic movement out there. Radoni's peeling out there from the midfield at times as well. And then for Sims and Hadji Wright, it's just about timing there, runs perfectly, which on that occasion Hadji Wright did, as well as the desire to get to the ball.
Bidwell chipping it forward here for Coventry. Radoni chasing after it. What a start he's had to the game. Knocked away from him on this occasion, though. Harris, leading the Oxford line, is being given a few fight balls to try and deal with, and not a lot else. And even worried to be able to win them. The four in behind him in the Oxford midfield, ahead of Will Vox, a long way from him. So he's got a thankless task tonight. Here's Radoni. What a ball that is. Hadji Wright. Sims stretches. Can't reach it. Sakamoto picks it up. Still inside the penalty area. He's played it back. Great dummy by Torp. Radoni coming onto it. Might get a second bite of the cherry after it was played back into him. And it's all hands to the defensive pump here for Oxford. Puerheta's going to be able to turn neatly and should be able to bring it away. But what a pass from Radoni to get Hadji Wright in.
Yeah, it's brilliant and long on this right-hand side. He just can't deal with Hadji Wright. He's being really clever, don't get me wrong. We know he's got back to pace, but his movement, the little checks to either side to then just create himself a little half a yard and put the doubt in Long's mind is brilliant. That ball as well on first time is exactly what the centre-forward wants. And for me, Ellis Sims has got to do better there.
Bidwell bringing it forward for Coventry. Edge of the penalty area. Wright has it again, but Long this time was able to force him away and push him in towards trouble. Volks coming in. Wright dispenses with the ball, plays it back to Eccles. Eccles to Laddie Baudiere and now to Binks and back out towards Josh Eccles again. And there's more space for Bidwell. And Bidwell getting it in. Sims making the run. Clear though in front of him by Moore. And out for a throw that'll be taken on the Coventry left. They lead 1-0 here on TalkSport 2 with 18 minutes gone. Eccles again, left-hand side of the penalty area. That one blocked by Long. We'll go down towards the corner flag, and it's gone over the line and out of play for a corner. It was a close-run thing. Long got a touch and flicked it out for what might have been an Oxford throw because it took a touch off Eccles, but it had already rolled over the dead ball line first. So Victor Torp's going to come across to take this corner. On the Coventry left, they already lead 1-0 and they're hungry for more. Sims standing right in front of the goalkeeper. Bidwell takes up station inside the six-yard box again. Sakamoto making a darting run, showing for the short one. Puajeta keeping an eye on him. It's Rodoni that's waiting on the edge of the penalty area in an unmarked position this time. A talk goes in very deep towards the far post. First contact from an Oxford player. Second one as well. Back in from Sakamoto. Trying to get Sims into a position to get a shot in on the turn. Brown stops that happening a second time. Then Rodoni with an exaggerated chip over the top. And Hadji Wright is flagged offside. All Coventry, though. Certainly when the goal went in, they were beginning to be able to turn the screw. They've been the better side in the 5 minutes since taking the lead. And it's 1-0 with 20 minutes gone.
Yeah, and Hadji Wright's work, I just want to mention something. Just in that passage of play before the corner, Long has come in really narrow with Hadji Wright because now he's worried and he's almost man-marking him. And that left so much space for Bidwell to come on. And that's why he had so much time on the ball when it came to him, because now Long is worrying, rightly so, about Hadji Wright. And that's how forwards and the way that they run and their movement creates doubt in the defender's mind.
Matt Rodoni, who's bossing the midfield, winning it back, finding Victor Torp. Torp to Wright. Wright coming into a central area again, and long-range effort from Eccles. And the keeper had it covered. It was 33, 34 yards out when he pulled the trigger. Didn't quite have the power, certainly didn't have the accuracy. It was easy for Cumming to make an early decision and let the ball go past the post. The first goal that Oxford have conceded this season, and the first that Cov have scored in the league. 1-0, they're good value for it as well.
Yeah, they are, and it's interesting the way it opens up for Eccles there, and that's because I think now Oxford are starting to panic a little bit. They're starting to drop off, so now it's leaving the space in front rather than in behind, and those long-range shots might be something that we see a little bit more of if Oxford keep dropping deeper and deeper.
Goodrum comes forward, and the home crowd not happy that a free kick's been given against Victor Torp. And here's a chance for Oxford to load the penalty area again, although the free kick is in quite a deep position. They're 3 or 4 yards in from the right-hand touchline. Coventry will hold a defensive line just outside the penalty area. The blue sky overhead, a cloudless sky, just beginning to darken a little as sunset contemplates making an appearance. Volks take the free kick, didn't get the elevation on it at all that was necessary. It was headed away, back in from Ruben Rodriguez, and it might break towards the edge of the penalty area. It does, slotted in to the bottom left hand corner. Kieran Brown making it 1-1 out of nothing. Oxford are back on level terms. Set piece that looked innocuous, an ineffective clearance back into the fray, and Brown is there. One apiece.
Coventry City, they'll be so disappointed with this. Can you spot on, Jim? It's about the first clearance. Doesn't clear the first man, but the header's got to be better. Instead of being out forward, it almost comes off the top of the head, spins back in towards the edge of the box. And then at that point, it's a fight scene. It's bobbling absolutely everywhere. But you've got to give credit to Brown, the fact that he's on his toes, he's anticipating where the ball's going to drop. And it's a really good composed finish and just slots it in that bottom left-hand corner. And I'll be honest, on the balance of play, do Oxford United deserve that? Probably not, but that's not how football's played. They've took the opportunity when it's come. Fair credit to them.
Well, Brown was in there initially to win the second ball by the penalty spot, and he just guided it down, flicked back into his path by Ruben Rodriguez. And Brown, who's not renowned for being a goal scorer, with a crisp finish, slotting it into the bottom left-hand corner for only the 10th senior goal of his career. So we get to the midway stage of the first half, and it's 1-1. Now, Jack Rodoni for Coventry. That fly from distance, maybe not quite as close as the crowd reaction would have you believe, but he smacked it. What a favourite he is going to be here.
Yeah, he's been excellent so far. And again, he's on that half turn. The ball comes into him. Oxford United defensive line has dropped, and the way that it sits up after his first touch is wonderful. It just bounces up ever so slightly so he can hit it almost on the half volley. And that is absolutely travelling. If that's on target, there's absolutely no chance that Cumming saving it. But luckily for him, flies past the post.
Harris for Oxford. Little 1-2 over on the far touchline. And then we'll play it deeper for the United goal scorer, Kieran Brown. Player's got previous championship experience with Cardiff. A lot of the Oxford players have played at this kind of level before. Here's one that hasn't, Elliot Moore, who played in the Belgian top flight but never in either of the English top two divisions prior to last week. Hadji Wright for Coventry, bringing it forward, slotted towards the edge of the 6-yard box. Peel for handball. It would have been ball to hand rather than anything else, I think. Sakamoto, the penalty wasn't given anyway. Sakamoto's got it. Boheta gets it away from him. It's the first instalment of a battle that Sakamoto has lost. And then he comes back, follow Boheta 30 yards. Brilliantly timed sliding challenge. Wins it back and gets Coventry on the front foot again. His initial movement was straight out into space on the right-hand touchline. And he got the return ball. Eccles now can bring it forward. He finds Torp. Torp will play down to the Coventry left-hand side for Bidwell. Bidwell controlling it. Back for Torp once more. Still 0-0 at Old Trafford. Live over on Talksport. Mason Mount in the book. But still 0-0. And shots at a premium there. United yet to have a single attempt. It's live for you right now over on Talksport. Here 1-1 with 25 minutes gone.
Absolutely love that on the right hand side by Sakamoto, by the way. The attitude, loses it, but to get it back.
Torp, Eccles slotting it through towards Wright. Wright's got it, goes towards the byline. Well timed challenge by Brown. He's just about to work a left footed cross through the 6-yard box. And Brown, in the nick of time, slid in. Where if he got the man first, he was giving a penalty away. But he timed his challenge brilliantly, puts it out of play for a corner.
Yeah, and it's a good reaction from Coventry City, by the way. After that equaliser, they're almost like services resumed. They're not letting it get to them too much, just trying to get the noses back in front again.
So they've got a corner, which is their third of the game. They'll be taken on the Coventry left as they send some of the substitutes out to warm up. In towards the edge of the 6-yard box, it's half cleared. Radoni, a clever feathered volley ball out towards the right-hand side. That one's cleared as well. Back out to Radoni again. And it might be his first mistake of the season with a ball that bypassed Eccles. Wanted it on his right foot. He played it the other side of his left. And he stretched but couldn't reach it. Guys out of play for a throw that'll be taken over on the Oxford left. Hugely enjoyable. 26 minutes behind us.
Yeah, I think the main issue for Oxford United right now is they've got to find a way of trying to stopping Jack Radoni. He's been absolutely brilliant both ends of the pitch defensively, but especially going forward, picking up the pockets in front of that defence, and that needs to change. They need to stem that flow from him.
And now Oxford can bring it forward again with Tyler Goodrum. Goodrum back for Long. Long to his left-hand side for Vox. Brannigan can bring it forward here. The player's got a fantastic reputation from the penalty spot, Cam Brannigan, the one-time Liverpool trainee. And he comes down to the Oxford right-hand side for Goodrum. Goodrum taking the ball, but unable to turn. What he was able to do, though, is dart between Wright and Bidwell, and all of a sudden find himself in 5 yards of space in the centre of midfield. Passes it on to Brannigan. From him to Bennett to Boheta. Boheta will continue his run. Lovely turn from Goodrum. Now playing it inside left for a moment. Into the feet of Harris. Goodrum takes over again. Knocked away by Binks. Only half away. Coventry clear their lines to Sam Long. Volks to Brannigan. Brannigan twisting one way and then the other. Boheta helping it on. And then it just breaks down as Van Aiwhite came across and stopped Harris reacting quickly enough. And the ball was passed him into the penalty area. And it's safely in the hands of the Coventry goalkeeper, Oliver Dovin.
Yeah, and as the exception of that last ball into the box, that's probably what Oxford United want to do more in terms of in that final third, move the ball quickly and efficiently, try and fashion a chance to say the ball wasn't what they wanted in the end, but it's a good passage.
Coventry with a quick switch of play. Hadji Wright's got that again, left-hand side of the penalty area. And has won another corner as his cross hit long and spun really high up in the air. And then by the time it came down, there was nothing coming could do about it to keep it in. So fourth corner without reply for Coventry City, which they will take on their left-hand side. 1-1. Hadji Wright on 15. Kieran Brown equalising 7 minutes later for Oxford. Sakamoto again, showing for the short one. And the corner is played into him. Then he works it behind square outside the area. Radoni, left-footed curving ball. Far post header back in. And the goalkeeper's able to catch the header from right as it was worked back from the dead ball line. Right swivel, headed it towards goal. But he didn't get the power that he did with his previous header. And Cumming could make a relatively comfortable save, bearing in mind the proximity of Wright's header towards goal. Another really well worked set piece.
Yeah, and I like that. And I think it's Binks at that back stick area that does really well to keep the ball in. I think the only thing for Hadji Wright is he's not got too much pace on it, so he's got to try and generate all the pace on the ball. And even being that close to the goal, it's difficult. So right place, right time, positive from Coventry City in terms of the movement, the ball back in. Just that little finishing touch from Hadji Wright, but it was a difficult opportunity.
He was left out of the starting 11 last week, Hadji Wright. And Coventry making three changes today to the team that lost at Stoke, where Mark Robbins didn't pull any punches after the performance. He was happy to say that he was dismayed by what he'd seen. They've been much better tonight. Alan Thomas and Mason Clark dropping to the bench. Wright, Eccles and Laddie Baudier coming in. Here's Hadji Wright again, maybe feeling he's got a point to prove. Inside the area, right-footed shot. Telegraph really the fact that he was going to cut in onto his right foot, and it made it easy for Volks to get the block in. There was the opportunity to slip in Bidwell on the overlap, and that's a point that the left back is making to him now.
Yeah, and that's because Long doesn't know whether to stick or twist. There was, say, half a second, it was a little bit more than that, when he doesn't know whether to go to Hadji Wright or hold his position and track Bidwell. Does neither, and if Hadji Wright can just play that ball through, Bidwell would have been in acres of space down this left-hand side of the box.
You would talk sport too over on Talksport, still nil-nil at Old Trafford. Here 1-1 on Talksport 2 between Coventry and Oxford, as Bidwell plays the ball forward and right with quick feet. Beat two, couldn't beat a third. It might break Sakamoto. Great dummy fan anyway. 2-1 Coventry. It's a thing of beauty. They've been magnificent to watch going forward tonight. Such great understanding around the edge of the penalty area, and Sakamoto's dummy sensational. Milan Fadeway comes onto it, rasps it home with a shot into the bottom left-hand corner, and Coventry lead again.
What a wonderful goal. There's so much to like about this, as you said, Jim. It's liquid, it's understanding the dummy, the strike on the ball as well. And by Van Aveyk, this is so, so difficult to hit a ball on the run with that much power, but also that much control. And it's almost like he passes it into the net, but it's not, because he hits it with his laces, I think, and it's so powerful. But the whole build-up to that goal, Robbins, he was disappointed, wasn't he, with their performance at the start of the season. But he'll be happy, very, very happy with what he's just seen, as are all of these fans inside the CBS.
Well, I've just seen a replay. As the ball comes in from the left-hand side of the penalty area, Ellis Sims has tried to play it and has missed it. Sakamoto, a second later, has absolutely mirrored what Sims did, as if he's taking the mickey out of him. But he's fully intended to do what he did, and he's left it for Van Aveyk, who's run onto it and scored. 2-1 Coventry. That, I know from experience, when you're an away fan, you never applaud a good goal scored by the opposition. But if ever you were going to, there might be one or two of the hipsters in the Oxford end might have looked at that and gone, you know what, that is a really good goal, fair play. You'd almost applaud it as an away fan, it was that good. 2-1 to Coventry, and Oxford have got it all to do again to get themselves back into it.
I think I mentioned it, the right-hand side for Coventry City is so dangerous, and the relationship between Sakamoto and Van Aveyk, it was so evident already through the game, but especially with that passage of play. Sakamoto, knowing that his fullback's going to be running on and can get onto this ball, and yeah, the finish was beautiful as well.
So Coventry coming forward again. Laddie Baudier out towards Van Aveyk. It's only his third goal for the club, incidentally, in more than 50 appearances. The one that he won't forget. Eccles just lending the ball to Sakamoto, getting it straight back, and then as it's worked down the inside right channel through the area for Radoni, all he can do is stand and applaud the intent of the pass as it whistles past him and goes straight into the hoardings behind Jamie Cumming's goal. What does Des Buckingham do, Courtney Sweetman-Kirk, to try and stem the flow at the moment?
Well, for me, Volks, I mean, he's next to his opposite number there in terms of being closer to Radoni, but I think you almost need to go man-to-man with him because that's one of the main issues for me. Radoni, as soon as he gets on the half turn, he's finding the wide areas, he's finding Hadji Wright in those little pockets, he's finding Sakamoto, then Van Aanholt's getting on and supports him as well. So that, for me, you've got to stem the flow from Radoni, and Long's got to be better as well.
Bidwell, right, taking it on, the angle's tight, but not prohibitive. He gets a shot in towards the near post, which is blocked by Cumming. At the moment, every time Coventry push forward, it looks as though they are going to score. Torp, Eccles, Bidwell, then to Torp and right, back for Binks and Laddie Baudière, and now to Sakamoto. And within about 15 seconds, nearly every Coventry outfield player has touched the ball in this move. Sakamoto with an opportunity to deliver from that right flank, but has sold the ball short towards Radoni, and Oxford can bring it away, firstly with Volks, and now through the midfield with Ruben Rodriguez. High ball over the top for Header's going to chase that. He's got plenty of pace, and he's got goal side of Van Aanholt, but the referee said that it's a free kick to Coventry, whether that was a handball or whether he's pulled his man back, I'm not sure, but it is a free kick which will be taken by the Sky Blues just outside their own penalty area. Nicked a few yards actually in taking it. 10 to go to half time. Tomorrow, Premier League action from Portman Road for the first time in more than 20 years, and their match, Ipswich at home to Liverpool, is live and exclusive on Game Day Live. 11 o'clock the build-up starts ahead of a 12:30 kickoff. And Championship action at the same time as that. Leeds have had a rotten start of the season. 3-3 draw with Portsmouth and a 3-0 home defeat at Middlesbrough in the League Cup. They're at West Brom tomorrow. And that also kicks off at 12:30. And it's here on TalkSport 2. Tell you what else is coming your way tomorrow very shortly. Bidwell, the here and now. Coventry 2, Oxford 1. 8 goals when the two sides met here last season. 3 inside the opening half hour or so tonight. Laddie Baudière chipping it forward. It's headed away by Long. Comes down to the Coventry left-hand side for Victor Torp, who can control it. Play it back for Binks. Binks is just waiting for some movement ahead of him. Looking for Radoni. Whenever any of the Coventry players at the back pick up possession, it looks as though their first thought is to try and get it into the feet of Jack Radoni. They can't at the moment, although he's still got a little bit of space. Laddie Baudière goes wide out towards the right for Van Aanholt, and he will play back towards halfway again. 2-1 to Coventry, and increasingly good value for it.
Yeah, and it's a shame that didn't come off there. They're trying to get Bidwell down that left-hand side, but Hadji Wright has been fantastic, and I'm talking about even more off the ball at the moment. He's been great on the ball, but off the ball, the way that he keeps peeling in, he's coming off the back shoulder of Long, he's going on to Moore, and then at the last minute he darts back out, and Long really doesn't know whether to stick or twist. Then Bidwell's getting really high, Goodrum doesn't know what to do. Does he stay and, you know, be a little bit of an outlet for his team? Does he come back with Bidwell? Again, with him and Long, I think the communication isn't the best at the moment, and you know, Bidwell and Hadji Wright down that left-hand side, they're having the time of their lives.
Those are the thoughts of the former Sheffield United women's striker, Courtney Sweetman-Kirk. Game Day Live tomorrow, 2:30 on TalkSport. All of the goals as they go in with the award-winning Adrian Durham. And here on TalkSport 2 tomorrow afternoon, more live and exclusive Premier League action as Newcastle begin their campaign at home to newly promoted Southampton. Saints getting the long trip out of the way on the opening day. Newcastle-Southampton, 3 o'clock kickoff here on TalkSport 2 with Ian Danter taking through the action from St James's tomorrow. 2-1 Coventry leading Oxford.
Looking at this, Jim, and I don't know if Oxford maybe need a change in formation as well, because Harris is the only one at times, especially when the balls are a bit longer against that Coventry back four. They're getting overrun in the midfield. They play almost like a 4-1-4-1.
Harris has it now, and he's played it to Ruben Rodriguez. His ball out towards the right-hand side for Goodrum wasn't great, and the youngster had to run all the way around it. It is a ball that's fired inside the penalty area from Long, and then put a header at the far post as it ricocheted up in the air, headed wide, hit the side netting. The goalkeeper was scrambling, but Dovin probably did have it covered.
And it works when they get bodies higher and in the boxes, we've seen there. I think you mentioned earlier as well, Jim, when that long ball goes up to Harris, it's a bit of a fight scene. You're playing effectively 4v1 because they're playing that 4-1-4-1 formation. it's not working for me. If they've got to sit a little bit deeper, which they're having to, I think they need to tweak it and potentially match Coventry up in a 4-3-3, or maybe even go to a 4-4-2, and you can drop your midfielders in as and when you want.
Well, Hector clears his lines, it goes out of play over on the far touchline for a throw. On the Oxford bench, they've got McEachran, Phillips, Ebue, Sibley, El Mazzuni, Lee, Kyoso and Scarlett. So a real mix, as you would anticipate, on the bench. 6 minutes to go to half time, with Torp in possession. Plays the ball down towards Bidwell. And then Bidwell goes back for Binks on halfway. Jake Bidwell again. Man who had more than 200 games at Brentford. Start their Premier League campaign on Sunday, incidentally. They're in a London derby, the first 42 Premier League London derbies this season as they take on Palace. High ball comes down towards Bidwell, left-hand side of the penalty area. Bidwell swinging it in, headed away. Brought down then by Ruben Rodriguez. Poor touch. Eccles wasn't necessarily anticipated. It was going to be a touch quite as bad as that. It was in there on the lunge, right foot. He's just a little bit on his heels. He got it clear. And it goes out of play for a throw that will be taken on the Oxford right. And Elliot Moore's in no hurry to take it. You wouldn't be, because it's all Coventry possession at the moment, with five to go to half-time.
I've just watched Goodrum, and don't get me wrong, that is a nice ball into Bidwell. But what he does is he watches the ball, he watches Bidwell on his back shoulder, he sees him run, and then he watches the ball go over him and then makes the run. It's absolutely incredible. You've got to track your runner earlier than that.
Ball's gone out for a throw, which will be taken on the Coventry left. Taken by Bidwell. The floodlights really coming to the fore now as the night begins to fall pretty quickly. Eccles towards Van Aewijk. He'll come in off the right-hand touchline. The Dutchman back for Eccles again. Now to Sakamoto. Sakamoto rolling it down the right-hand side of the penalty area. Van Aewijk can't get past Brannigan, but he does win a throw. It's his goal that separates the sides after Hadji Wright's opener was cancelled out by Kieran Brown. Three goals in a 16-minute spell. And that's the way it remains. 2-1 to Coventry. Bidwell in possession. Jim Proudfoot and Courtney Sweetman-Kirk talking through the action of the CBS Arena tonight. Magnificent stadium, so good to see Coventry back playing football here in Coventry and here at this ground. Goodrum. Play forward by Long for Oxford. And then Goodrum just scooping the ball out from underneath his right foot, almost a little pitching wedge forward. And Laddie Baudier testing the footballing ability of his new goalkeeper, Oliver Dovin, with a brisk back pass to the left-hand side of the penalty area that he did well to deal with. Laddie Baudier then has passed his own examination after that, because as they were trying to beat the Oxford press by necessity, not through desire, there were two of them and four in yellow shirts trying to force the error. Laddie Baudier gets it away. He did well. Des Buckingham liked what he saw, though. Might not like this so much. Oh, it's okay. Bennett steps up and gets away from Sakamoto. And then it's a good ball down the line from Bennett. And Proheta will chase after it. Level the edge of the penalty area. High ball towards Harris at the far post. And Bink sends it away for Oxford's first corner of the night. 42 gone, 2-1.
It's not a bad idea. I like that run from Proheta as well. They're sort of inside to out. Gets a good crossing as well. Harris is the only teammate that he's got to aim to. It nearly gets there, but Binks watches it all the way. But that's the issue I was talking about earlier. They do well in the transition, but if you've only got one teammate to aim for in the box, it's always going to be difficult.
Volks will come across to the Oxford right to take this corner. And it takes charge of many of the set pieces. And the principal targets are all at the back post at the moment. The two centre-halves, Moore and Brown. Long is in there as well. Only Goodrum has stayed back. Goes in really deep. Coventry with a very good first touch to get it away. I think it was Binks that got his head to it. Now he goes out of play for an Oxford throw. They've taken it quickly. Goodrum to Proheta. And the blonde-haired Polish international goes square to his right-hand side for Volks. So ball swung it round the back. And Brown made the run. And it just went past him. And goes out of play for a goal kick. And Oxford haven't really caused too many problems for Coventry, but from set pieces and from the second phase of play from set pieces, Sky Blues are struggling to cope at times.
Yeah, great ball. Came out my mouth as soon as it left Volks' foot. And I think in all fairness to Brown, I don't think he can make his run any earlier or be offside, and he's stretching everything to try and get there. But those balls in behind the defence, they can cause so many problems. But you're right, Jim, from set pieces, from the second phase, they do well to keep it alive, and they have got very good deliverers of the ball in their side, Oxford United.
Well, we've got a minute to go to half time, and I don't think there's going to be too much stoppage time to be added on after that, just the time that was taken to celebrate the goals, although that has come down for the new season. Wright sending a high ball through the penalty area to Sakamoto on the right-hand side of the box. Back for Radoni, and it's clear, picked up by Ladibodier for Coventry. He goes to his left for Binks. Binks down towards Hadji Wright again, who opened the scoring with a bullet header 15 minutes in after a good ball from Van Aewijk. Wright sending a delicious ball towards the far post. Nobody could get there. Sakamoto mops up. He plays it back in and straight into the chest of goalkeeper Cumming. That is one of the changes for the new season, incidentally. So after every goal, they used to add on all of the time spent celebrating. Now, the first 30 seconds of that celebration don't count. So in theory, first half stoppage time at the end of this game, for instance, is going to be 90 seconds shorter than it would have been last season. So there won't be too much time to be added on, maybe a minute, two at the most. Fourth official, James Linnington, has got the ball in his hand and has just come towards the near touchline. It is 2 minutes to be added. 2-1 as we go into it, Courtney.
Yeah, and rightly so. I think there was a lot of questions around player welfare, wasn't there, in the amount of times being added on games. The celebrations, rightly so, are part of the game. Those extended ones, 100% time needs to be added on, but I think common sense has prevailed in that sense.
Hess is on the right flank just for a moment for Oxford, having played exclusively on the left up to now. He's just lost his way as he makes his way through the midfield. He lost possession. Goodrum's gone out to the left and Poeheta to the right. So maybe that's the switch has been made, really defensively minded, to try and cope with Hadji Wright and the movement off the ball a little bit better, because you illustrated the problems Goodrum was having.
Yeah, but equally so, the fullback, the right fullback for Coventry City, Van Aewijk, he also likes to get forward as well. So tracking them runs, whether it be Bidwell, the left back, or Van Aewijk on the right hand side, he's still got to make sure Goodrum that he's doing that job, because it's been poor so far. And it's just a bit of a naivety. You can't just watch the ball go over and then follow later.
And now Volk's committing himself in the midfield, and Eccles was able to play round him, and Sims has given Brown a shove. That's how the assistant referee on the far side saw it. He had a really good view. You'll judge by the reaction of the Sky Blues fans around us that it's not a decision that they necessarily agree with.
No, and I think there's been a few of them tonight from the officials where, yes, there's been contact, but it's a contact game. Let it play on. And I think that at times it's been stopped a little bit too much for me.
Well, the significance of that decision was that Sims was pretty much in on goal. Had the referee allowed play to go on, he didn't, and it will be a free kick, which will be taken by Oxford goalkeeper Jamie Cumming, just outside his penalty area. Binks turning it back towards the edge of his own box as he got on the end of it. Ladibodier clears that. Long returns it. Oxford has still got it in Coventry territory, but the 2 minutes of added time are up, and that will do. That'll be a really good ovation from the Coventry fans to their team as they leave the field. 45 minutes, two very different but very well taken goals. Oxford have had their moments sporadically, but did well to score after a set piece from Kieran Brown. They got themselves back into the game. Coventry's response was excellent. And Courtney, I'm sure that you agree with me that the Sky Blues deserve the half-time advantage.
Yeah, they do. I think the way that they started the game with a lot of tempo, a lot of aggression, and set out their stall very early in terms of, you could see the high press. They wanted to try and win the ball high up the pitch. And I think on the ball as well, they've been a lot better. They've showed that little bit extra quality compared to Oxford United. And Jack Radoni, for me, has absolutely ran the show in the midfield. He's been brilliant so far. And for him, getting on the half turn, and whether it's playing the ball out to the right or the left-hand side, it's normally been weighted to perfection. And everyone around him, you can see his teammates, they're all on the same wavelength. They're making the runs. And, two very different goals, but two that, as a forward myself, I like for two different reasons. Hadji Wright, the aggression, the header to want to get above the defender and put the ball in the back of the net. And then the finesse on the finish from the right-back Van Aewijk was fantastic as well.
If you were Des Buckingham, would you be contemplating making a change now, or do you give it an extra 10, 15 minutes? Because in that first half, you were talking about maybe altering the formation. Does he do that with the same personnel to start with, or does he need to make more widespread changes than that?
I would say it's a tweak. I think you say to Volt, you need to stay on Radoni and that's it. Don't think about anything else. Just make sure he doesn't get on the ball. I think Goodrum is one of them ones where, as a manager, especially because you're on that side as well, he would have seen some of the things that I've seen and thought, that isn't good enough. Yes, some of it's naivety, and maybe he might have been a little bit overwhelmed, but some of it, from the outside, looks like it's a willingness to work, and he doesn't want to track back, and that isn't acceptable.
Well, Goodrum got switched from right flank to left for the last couple of minutes, so it'll be interesting to see whether he and Guajeta stay that way round, or whether they start the second half the way that they started the game, with Guajeta on the left and Goodrum on the right. The Coventry substitutes are out warming up at the moment. No Oxford subs are out there warming up. We'll bring you the second half, of course. A reminder that over on Talksport right now, they're discussing the first half from Old Trafford. Manchester United 0, Fulham 0. Half-time highlights from Old Trafford to come very shortly. And we'll have more reflections on the first half here and the second half to come as well. Coventry 2, Oxford 1 at the break on Talksport 2.
Mum, Dad, I'm back.
It'll only be for
2 weeks.
A month, tops.
Till the roof's fixed.
Till we get our deposit.
Where's the remote?
Still got Netflix.
TNT Sport.
Where's now?
TV that flexes with your home? New EE TV lets you turn your subscriptions on and off as and when you need. Search EE TV today.
EE TV requires EE broadband. 24-month contracts. Content may vary. Terms apply.
Say hello to Chase, awarded Best British Bank by our customers.
Tell me more.
Well, it's quick and easy to open a Chase account.
Anything else?
We charge no fees when you use your Chase debit card abroad.
Great. I'm saving to go to Antigua. Can I open a Saver account?
Yes, you can add up to 10 separate Saver accounts.
Hang on, so I could also open one for that festival I want to go to?
Absolutely.
Ooh, and a spa weekend after.
It would be rude not to.
Where do I sign up?
You can download the Chase app today. Chase, awarded Best British Bank by our customers.
18 plus UK residents. Chase current account required.
At Crown Trade, we ask painters and decorators, how spicy do you like a curry?
Oh, mild, definitely.
Medium for me.
Stick the toilet roll in the fridge and let's go for it.
At least there's one thing they do agree on. There's no better paint than Crown.
Crown.
Crown Trade. It goes on great.
97% of painters and decorators who use Crown Trade agree. There's no better paint. It's not just paint, it's personal. Survey of 187 professional decorators.
When someone you love dies,
Daddy!
A crow carries their soul to the land of the dead.
You have no idea what hell awaits you.
And sometimes something so bad happens.
Please don't do this!
That the soul cannot rest.
I'm gonna kill every single one of them.
The Crow in cinemas August 23. Book tickets now. Certificate 18.
That's not simple. That's not simple. Now that's simple. Hastings Direct Car Insurance is simple. Because when life is this complicated, finding a great deal shouldn't be. Great cover, great price, and a great app makes us one of the UK's top choices when comparing car insurance online. Hastings Direct. Simplicity is the best policy. For verification, see hastingsdirect.com/verify.
This season, stream Sky Sports on Now.
Players are ready, and now we're off. What a nutmeg! Now he must score!
Now how has he missed that? Now that was death on a pen!
Now the ref's got to send him off! Now that must be the match winner!
Head to nowtv.com and stream Sky Sports with no contract.
Now that is world class!
18 plus UK only, 6 month saver option also available.
TalkSport 2, official broadcast partner of the Premier League and the English Football League. Saturday afternoon.
Live Championship football.
On TalkSport 2.
And he's gone straight in!
West Brom versus Leeds United.
Coverage from 12 noon. Kick-off 12:30.
What a great bit of play.
Saturday afternoon.
On Live Football Dynamo.
TalkSport 2. A brand new season of fast-paced football is on the way.
Oh!
yes!
Listen to TalkSport and TalkSport 2 and get the latest transfer news first.
They are turning up the heat.
Get all the rumour and reports and our fast-moving transfer updates across the day with instant reaction from the biggest names in the game.
What a way to do it!
Plus, find a full transfer roundup at TalkSport.com.
Listen to that!
Transfer updates throughout the day on TalkSport and TalkSport 2.
Feel the power and the glory.
It's goal time.
And he scored. It's a brilliant goal.
Fired up and raring to go. EFL Live on TalkSport 2.
Two clubs on the up after enduring some of the darkest days. Oxford's best finish in a quarter of a century is guaranteed. Coventry hope for their best in 24 years, and that could be the passport to a return to the Premier League. Sakamoto to his right inside the penalty area, trying a shot which is blocked, and Oxford can get it away. Vanney White picks it up, now on the edge of the penalty area, Sakamoto with a good disguised ball in, and there's the header from Hadji Wright. 1-0 Coventry. What a start to their home campaign. Back in from Ruben Rodriguez, and might break towards the edge of the penalty area. He does slot it in to the bottom left-hand corner. Kieran Brown making it 1-1.
And it's a really good composed finish and just slots it in that bottom left-hand corner. And I'll be honest, on the balance of play, do Oxford United deserve that? Probably not, but that's not how football's played. They've took the opportunity when it's come. Fair credit to them.
Bidwell plays the ball forward and right with quick feet. Beat two, couldn't beat a third. It might break Sakamoto. Great dummy, Fanaway! 2-1 Coventry. It's a thing of beauty.
What a wonderful goal. There's so much to like about this, as you said, Jim. It's liquid.
And that will do. That'll be a really good ovation from the Coventry fans to their team as they leave the field. And that's the way of it at half-time. 2-1 to Coventry. Oxford are warming up Matt Phillips. No confirmation as yet as to the exact change that will be made. It may well be Phillips for Goodrum ahead of the second half for Oxford. 2-1. We've got a choice of listening for you tonight. As you know, over on TalkSport right now, got live Premier League action from Old Trafford with Manchester United up against Fulham. 0-0 at the break. This is how the first half played out.
And there were a lot of lows last season, and despite it being their worst ever Premier League campaign, Ten Hag has been given a second chance to tailor his team into Manchester United, Eric's version.
Here at the other end, the ball being brought away by Kenny Tete, who comes forward and then shoots from distance towards the post. It's Stefan Anana has to spring up with his left hand and push the ball over the top of the crossbar. Oh, given away by Leno, edge of the area. Now Fernandez outside of the boot, hits it straight at the goalkeeper, who makes a save and redeems himself. Casemiro reaches the line. Fernandez hits it straight against Leno, comes out, makes himself brilliantly big and stops a certain goal for Manchester United. At the break, it is Manchester United 0, Fulham 0.
And so no breakthrough for either club at the moment. The second half of that one is live on TalkSport. And if you've got the TalkSport app, if you have it, you can download it from your app store. But if you've got the app, then it's very easy just to seamlessly swipe between the two games at Old Trafford and here at the CBS Arena in Coventry. And the live Premier League football continues tomorrow afternoon here on TalkSport 2. Newcastle welcome newly promoted Southampton, who signed Cameron Archer today. One player in particular who's hoping to make an impact in that game, Newcastle's new signing defender Lloyd Kelly, who joined the club on a free transfer from Bournemouth this summer. And he's been speaking to TalkSport's Ollie Click.
Lloyd, thank you for speaking to TalkSport. Firstly, you're new in the door at St James's Park. What have your first impressions been since signing for Newcastle?
Yeah, it's been amazing. I just appreciate how open everyone was in accepting me, and I just can't wait to get started. Of course, the season's right around the corner. It's been a quick pre-season, but yeah, I'm looking forward to it for sure.
What attracted you most to joining Newcastle?
The number one thing is the size of the club. You can tell it's headed in one direction. Everything over the past 18 months has been positive for everyone involved in the club, all the way down to the supporters and the people who work here. So yeah, it was, they're on a project and I wanted to be a part of that. And of course, obviously knowing the gaffer from previously at Bournemouth, it kind of helped in that decision of working with him again and being comfortable in his coaching staff, and I know what he expects from his players. So, it kind of made sense.
It's the second time that you've been signed by Eddie Howe, as you say, linking up with him again. Have you noticed any differences about him as a coach since that time?
I think even for himself, he would want to have changed over those 5 years. He has done so. Being at this club, he's made vast improvements in the way he wants his players to play and things like that. So, yeah, it's just, of course, I knew him from previous and I had a little bit, kind of knew what he expected, but at the same time, there's things that I have to adapt and I have to kind of change into his playing style. So, yeah, that's what this pre-season has been for.
I know you're new in the door, but it's been a rollercoaster couple of seasons for Newcastle, qualifying for the Champions League. They narrowly missed out on Europe last season. What have the conversations been like about what you want to achieve in this campaign?
We've had a few discussions on what this season looks like, and everyone's on the same page of we want to achieve something. We want to strive for success. We don't want to just go through each season and go through the motions. The Champions League year was an amazing year for this club, and it kind of brought everyone together and made people realise what Newcastle can do. So of course we want to achieve that again and push on. We'll do everything we can to make it an exciting season again.
So that's Lloyd Kelly, the Newcastle United defender, speaking to TalkSport 2's Ollie Clink. Newcastle taking on Southampton tomorrow. Lloyd Kelly signing from Bournemouth, who within the last hour have just broken their club transfer record on the striker Evan Nielsen from Porto for an initial £32 million. That's a deal that could rise to 40. Obviously a deal that's funded by the sale of Dominic Solanke earlier this week. So Evan Nielsen signing for Bournemouth, and Southampton in action in that game at Newcastle. As I mentioned earlier, signing Cam Archer is one of the more bizarre deals of the transfer window, because Archer only signed for Villa 4 weeks ago in a £14 million deal for Middlesbrough. But he's been good in training over the last month, because he's now worth £15 million in signing for Southampton. So Cam Archer joining Southampton. Don't think in time for him to feature in that game tomorrow. And that's one of two live games from the Premier League that we've got on the TalkSport network tomorrow. That's a 3 o'clock kickoff here on 2. Over on TalkSport, Game Day Live starts at 11 with Reshmin Chowdhury and commentary from Joe Shannon, Scott Minto and the former Ipswich captain Luke Chambers of Ipswich's first game back in the elite in more than two decades as they take on Arne Slot's Liverpool. Ipswich Liverpool tomorrow from 12:30. And let me point you the way of some EFL action tomorrow at the same time here on TalkSport 2. West Brom against a Leeds side who've conceded six in their two games so far this season. It's a 12:30 kickoff here on 2. Then on Sunday, Sunderland against Sheffield Wednesday here on 2 from 12. And it's followed by Bolton against Wrexham in League One. Sunday session over on TalkSport with Sam Matterface on Sunday lunchtime. We'll keep up to date with all the goals as they go in from the Premier League and the EFL, including Brentford Palace and Chelsea against Manchester City. And the last game to flag up, Monday night, Leicester against Tottenham, which is a 7 o'clock build-up ahead of an 8 o'clock start. Now, if you missed yesterday's episode of EFL Fan Network with Justin Beattie, reflecting on the week's big stories in the EFL with members of the TalkSport Fan Network, it is available as a podcast, which you can download from your go-to podcast provider. It's also available to find on the TalkSport app. Just search the EFL All Access feed to find it. Coventry out for the second half already. Still waiting for Oxford to return. We're expecting that Matt Phillips is going to be coming on. Courtney Sweetman-Kirk still waiting for a confirmation as to the change that we've made. It may well be Goodrum who's coming off for the second half. But no surprise if Phillips comes on that Des Buckingham wants to make some changes.
No, I think it's one of those. It's unfortunate, isn't it? And the relationship between himself and Long at the back, I don't know whether it was communication error, whether there's a, in terms of communication with Des Buckingham, in terms of should I be tracking back with the fullback, where should I be? Should I be trying to give us a little bit of an outlet? But obviously Matt Phillips did well, didn't he, in the cup? I think he scored. nice little run from the sort of the left-hand side comes in, and a bit of a tap-in against Peterborough. So we know Matt Phillips in terms of the amount of experience he's got in the Championship, and he's a good player to bring on in this type of situation where you need a bit of a calm head and some experience.
Well, the change isn't happening yet. Goodrum has come back out. Wahetta has come back out as well. So Oxford aren't making any changes in personnel right now. But you would imagine that Phillips' introduction, judging by the intensity of his warm-up over the last 6 or 7 minutes, he's not going to be too far away. Coventry lining up then. Dobin in goal. Fanny White, Laddie Baudier, Binks and Bidwell, Radoni, Eccles and Tor, Sakamoto, Sims and Wright. Oxford have coming in goal. Long, Moore, Brown and Bennett, Volks, and then Goodrum, Rodriguez, Branigan and Puerheta and Harris. The referee is David Coote. Just one man in the book so far, Joe Bennett. Hadji Wright on 15, Kieran Brown equalising for Oxford on 22 before Van Aewijk, at the end of a brilliant move, gave the Sky Blues a 2-1 advantage. And judging by the reaction from some of the Coventry fans speaking to during the half-time interval, they felt that 2-1 flat at Oxford, and that Coventry should be further ahead by now. They're not, we're back underway. Coventry in their Sky Blue shirts and white shorts. They're kicking from left to right. Here's Radoni. Radoni spinning one out towards the left-hand side of the penalty area. Straight away for Hadji Wright. On the overlap for him is Bidwell. Chipping it back in. Sakamoto was waiting for it. Talk with a right-footed volley, which is deflected. And that goes out of play for a corner just 20 seconds into the second half.
And yet again, 20 seconds in. And we're mentioning Radoni does so well there. Vokes is closer to him, in all fairness. But just the composure, the sharpness of the movement and the quality of the touch means he can play that ball out to the left-hand side quickly and efficiently.
Corner to be taken on the Coventry right, the first of the second half, the fifth of the game. And it's going to be a left-footed in-swing. Sakamoto waits on the bottom right-hand corner of the penalty area. Plenty of movement coming in. Sims is in there towards the near post and very nearly got there. It's a good header away by Moore, just got it past him. And they'll do it all again. And they just headed it into the Oxford fans at that end of the ground. And straight out for another corner, which is Sky Blue's sixth of the game. And Radoni will come across to take it. A chance for him to swing it in with his left foot. Sakamoto doesn't show for the short one this time. He's now waiting in a more central position on the edge of the area. Then makes, as soon as I say that, a darting run back into that same position for which he was standing for the last one. It is in towards the near post. It's not the best delivery from Radoni. It's easily knocked away. But Sakamoto can pick it up. Goes back for the signing from Huddersfield again. Better ball in the second time of asking. Well headed away by Moore. And Oxford get the second touch as well to get it further clear. Dovin, the Coventry goalkeeper, is on the edge of the centre circle as he fields it. And Radoni's track back to find Joel Ladibaudier. And Coventry will be able to build from the back once more. A couple of minutes gone in the second half. All Coventry since the resumption, as it was in much of the last 10 minutes of the first half. Ball in from Radoni here for Sims. Got the power, but it was always rolling across his body, so he screwed it wide of the near post and out for a goal kick.
Oh, Des Cunningham must be pulling his hair out yet again. I sound like I'm the top member of the Jack Radoni fan club, but yet again, the position he finds himself in, this time, yes, still central in that number 10 role, but just to the right-hand side, slips a lovely ball down to Sims on the half-turn. Sims has got to do better there, gets all the power. I think he's trying to find the near post, but he's got to hit the target at bare minimum.
Well, your appreciation and membership of the Jack Radoni fan club is vindicated. Binks is going to be able to bring it forward, and you haven't got the exclusive on it either. The ball is one back by Oxford, and then a curious ball from Volks, who's volleyed it back behind his left back. Bennett actually mopped up and got it back to his goalkeeper. Cumming cleared it and finds Branigan. Branigan goes back to the edge of his own penalty area. Then it's worked forward towards Goodrum, who can hold it up and flick it down towards Branigan. Oxford have cleverly worked some space with Volks. Branigan again, out towards the right-hand side. Puerheta, though, slightly on his heels, and it was cut out easily by Bidwell. He steams forward down the left. They try and play him in to try and get him behind long, but it's gone out of play for a throw that will be taken by Oxford's right back midway inside his own half, over on the far touchline. 2-1 Coventry lead.
Just on slightly different wavelengths there, the Oxford United players. Puerheta, I think he wanted that ball in behind. He was ready to run in behind the fullback. The ball came to feet. He's already sort of on his heels. He can't get there quick enough.
They're a couple of minutes ahead of us at Old Trafford. 51 gone there, where it is still 0-0 between Manchester United and Fulham. And it's live for you right now over on TalkSport. Radoni to right, taking on the challenge is Elliot Moore to slide in and put it away. It's gone out for a throw rather than a corner. It's a good clearance.
Yeah, Moore does well there because he knows Hadji Wright's bearing down with his pace. He has to get the challenge right in the box and does so very well.
Throw is taken over on that Coventry left-hand side. Bidwell trying to feed it back towards Radoni on the edge of the penalty area. It's cleared and put forward long by Long, headed down by Eccles through the midfield. And Sakamoto loses out, just a little bit scrappy. Joe Bennett can stick his foot on the ball. Turned briskly round the corner by Goodrum on this left-hand side. And Van Aywijk, Ladibodiera, beg your pardon, is there to mop up. He's there ahead of Harris and can get it back to his goalkeeper. Dovin on the edge of the six-yard box. Side foots it back to his goalkeeper and then plays it out. Eccles can drop his shoulder in the midfield. Goodrum's done really well. He's won it back. Then it's played in towards Projeta by Rodriguez. It was a heavy touch and it forced Projeta wider than he wanted to go. He swings it back in. Too high for Rodriguez. And he goes out of play. Better ball from Rodriguez there for Projeta, and he might have had a shooting opportunity. But he overhit the pass. Projeta returned the favour by overhitting the cross.
Yeah, it's a real shame, Jim, because Oxford United were really well to win the ball back in a good area, and it's just then that little bit of composure, that weight of passing. They've spent so long without the ball, but that's the difference, that fire and ice that managers always used to call it when I was playing, is the fire to get there to win it back, but then you've got to have that coolness and that composure when you're on the ball to get the pass right.
Coventry won at Bristol City the other night in the League Cup to set up a second round tie here against Oxford. A game that I think is going to be played a week on Tuesday. And that win at Bristol City was Coventry's first in 9 games. You would imagine they'll make it 2 in 4 days over the next 40 minutes or so, the way that the game is going at the moment. But still, the lead is just the one. And Oxford, when they can get the press right and effective, have a chance of being able to create opportunities to engineer a way back into this game.
And you just see it now, actually, when they're sat in possession, they're more into a 4-4-2, so it gives Harris just a little bit of company.
Ellis Sims inside the Oxford box, firing it in. Right, good first touch, knocked away, though, by Long. And Oxford can get it clear, and Volks can bring it forward towards halfway. Brannigan to Ruben Rodriguez, now towards Harris, and Projeta making a run ahead of him. Van Aywijk defending it brilliantly, went shoulder to shoulder with him. And just as the Oxford man looked up to play the ball, he gave him a little surreptitious shove, won the ball back. Now he's on his bike himself. Fires it across from the right. And it bounces over the head of Long and then over the head of Hadji Wright over on the Coventry left. But he can turn brilliantly. Good pace from him. Gets towards the byline, gets the ball in. Sims with the flick header. Down to Van Aywijk again. He whips it back. Pulled it back towards the penalty spot. Brannigan's there to clear. Ladibodiere will mop up on halfway for Coventry. It will come again. So they can mix it up, Cobb, because they have the ability as well on the counter-attack. So anytime Oxford decide they're going to show a little bit more enterprise, it might just play into Coventry's hands.
Yeah, and that's the thing, especially when you're losing. You're almost damned if you do and damned if you don't as Oxford United, because if you sit in and try and play the block and not to concede anymore, then realistically you're not going to go forward and you're not going to get that equaliser. But as soon as you go forward, especially against experienced teams in this league like Coventry City, they're going to try and exploit you on the transition.
Well, Phillips has been called back to the bench and he's going to be coming on in a moment. And in fact, Oxford might be making a double change because I think El Mazzouni is also getting ready. Central midfielder that they signed from Ipswich in the summer, a Tunisian international who spent the last couple of years on loan at Leighton Orient. So El Mazzouni is going to be coming on and Phillips will be coming on as well. 8 minutes gone in the second half. Coventry 2, Oxford 1 here on TalkSport 2. This is the longest period in the game now without a goal. Gone just over 20 minutes without one. Ladibodiere on the edge of the centre circle to Josh Eccles. Turned forward through the midfield by Radoni. Now Van Aywijk flicking it back into his path. Radoni coming to meet it. Does well. Van Aywijk to Torp. Torpe controlling it. Down towards Radoni. Radoni on the right-hand side of the penalty area. Slipping it in towards Torpe. Goodrum did well. Put a foot in. Got back. Toe poked it away. His best 10 minutes have been the 10 minutes of the second half, Tyler Goodrum. It's clear by Moore, by Brown. Towards halfway for Oxford, but it's going to come straight back again. Van Aywhite once more. Scorer of the second goal. An assist and a goal to his name. And now a wonderful, sublime crossfield ball from right back to left back as he found Jake Bidwell. Coventry bring it forward. Then turn with Eccles. Going back to Binks. Binks to his left. Still Bidwell making his run forward. And still very heavily involved in the play over on the left-hand touchline. Back it goes for Wright, who's just drifted into a deeper position for a moment. That created space in the centre of midfield. And then Sakamoto was given a real shove to the ground. Referee says play on. Van Aywijk's got it for Coventry. Clipped inside the area from Torpe. He tried an exaggerated chip to get right in behind Brown. He didn't get enough height underneath the ball. And it's going to be cleared by Goodrum. I'm surprised, let's say, that a free kick wasn't given Sakamoto's way there. Still got the handprints of the Oxford player on his chest. Brannigan, left-hand side of the box at the other end, clipping it in. Unmarked diving header at the far post has crept in. It's a bizarre equaliser. And it's Ruben Rodriguez that's going to claim it, I think. Maybe Harris got the last touch. But it was a ball out of nothing, playing in from the left-hand side of the penalty area. And Rodriguez, he was only a foot off the ground, and he went for the diving header rather than the volley. And I think he just took a flick on his way through and somehow has ended up in the bottom left-hand corner.
Yeah, I agree, Jim. I'm sure it takes a little nick off Harris and just completely changes the flight of the ball. But I tell you what, if you're Coventry City, you're absolutely fuming. Because I don't get how that free kick hasn't been given down the Coventry right-hand side. It's a blatant push. Some of the fouls that we've seen given today by David Coote, I don't know how that's not a foul now. That doesn't excuse the defending going up the other end, and Oxford have done well to capitalise. As you mentioned, the diving header from Ruben Rodriguez, and he's been higher now to Harris, which has helped. And I don't know how much Harris knows about this when it comes off him, to be honest, but either way, somehow Oxford United are level.
Well, it was a diving header at the far post, and Harris peeling away from what was very nearly an offside position. It hit him on the thigh. I think it was a deliberate touch. I agree with you that the first inspection, I didn't think he knew anything about it at all, but I do think he sort of made a movement slightly towards the ball to help it in. But Oxford are back on level terms, and Mark Harris makes it 2-2 for the new season, 10 minutes into the second half. Oxford have made a double change. Phillips is on, but he's replaced Puerheta, and El Mazzuni is on for Rodriguez, who leaves the field with an assist for his last touch. Coventry 2, Oxford 2 on TalkSport 2. Laddy Baudier playing it back for Binks through the centre circle. Mark Robbins will be scratching his head. He's seen it all as a manager. He's the third longest serving manager in the league. He's been here 7.5 years in this spell. But he won't have had too many games like this over the 371 that he's had in charge of Coventry, where they've been so dominant and have allowed the opposition back in twice. Here's Radoni. So Sky Blues try to restore their advantage. Right side of the penalty area. It's off Brannigan. Comes back for Sakamoto. Left-footed ball in from him. Very deep. Bidwell climbing. Oxford win the first touch, and Vaux is going to be able to get it away with the second.
You mentioned it earlier, Jim, for all the dominance of Coventry, which we've praised. It's not come in terms of that third goal, and we know that football is a funny old game, and that's why we love it. And when it's only one goal that's separating two teams, it only takes something a bit peculiar like that or a mistake, and you're back on level terms, and Coventry will be kicking themselves for the amount of opportunities that they've spurned.
Goodrum has been better on the left than he was on the right by some distance. He's done well at the start of this second half, and if Des Buckingham was contemplating making a change at half-time, I'm sure it would have been Goodrum that was replaced, but he's been better than Puehet at the start of the second, and that's why the change was made that was, and now he's got it. And the referee's assistant gave himself a lot of thinking time there before flagging and giving a free kick for a foul by Brannigan on Van Aywhite. And Elliot Moore comes across, and he gets a yellow card. Now, he's the Oxford captain. Yeah, Van Aywai gets back to his feet, and there's some discussion going on between the two players, but Moore is in the book. 2-2.
I actually thought that was good by Gudrum. The fact is, getting back, he's trying to make the tackle. His performance at the start of this second half makes me think two things. Either the manager's giving him a right dressing down, or it was more of a tactical issue that maybe Gudrum didn't understand when to press, when to go, when to support your fullback, and when to give the team a little bit of an outlet. So maybe now that that's been talked through with the manager, he gets it a little bit more.
So a free kick to Coventry, just short of an hour. Jack Radoni is going to take it. Coventry 2, Oxford 2. So Radoni addresses the ball and then steps back away from it. Now Victor Torp comes across, so maybe he's going to be the man to swing it in. That would see it come at a different angle, away rather than into the penalty area. No, it is Radoni, flighted really high towards the far post. A looping header back into the fray, is headed away. Right-footed effort from Torp, and cleared from right in front of the goalkeeper for a corner.
That was travelling certainly on target. It looked like it was going to nestle in that bottom left-hand corner. Cumming and dived the right way, in all fairness to him, but the quality of the strike, I don't know whether he would have been able to save it if it wasn't for his defender.
So Radoni to take this latest corner, which is Coventry's seventh. Sakamoto, as always, waiting for it, but he's gone much deeper than that. The goalkeeper thought about coming and elected very hastily to take a step back, long headed it away. So goes out for another corner. And Victor Torp going out to take it on the far touchline. Just conducts the sky blue choir, waving his hands, asking for that little bit of extra volume. Eccles making a darting run. Harris is watching him from the edge of the penalty area. Plenty of jockeying for position. In swinging delivery. Really good header from Elliot Moore. Gets it towards halfway. Going to be picked up by Van Aywijk, and he then turns it back to his goalkeeper. Dovin driving it forward out towards the far touchline. And then on towards Sakamoto. Sakamoto over on the Coventry left at the moment with an hour played at 2-2. And then as he plays it in, it hits long, goes back into Sakamoto and out for a goal kick to be taken by Des Buckingham's Oxford. 2-2 here on TalkSport 2.
Isn't it funny how quickly momentum can change? You go from the first half and Sakamoto, absolutely electric. Everything he did turn to gold. Always consistently getting past his defender, and that time he's unlucky. It ricochets back off him. He looks up into the sky as if to say why, and got to give credit to Oxford. That second goal, yes, it came against the run of play, but they've built on that now and have got themselves back into the game.
And Joe Bennett helps it forward, but not to good effect. Van Aywijk tried a little nutmeg of Brannigan that didn't come off. It ricocheted back off the Scouser's foot and through the midfield for him to have a second bite of the cherry. Then Coventry in danger of driven it away. They have. Harris using his body cleverly, got there ahead of Laddie Baudier. Binks in strongly where he had to win it, and he did. Oxford bring it forward, though, over halfway out towards the right-hand side for Matt Phillips.
Just looking at Eccles as well. I think he hurt himself in the process. One of the challenges he put on there, I think Harris managed to skip past.
Phillips, a player who scored on his debut on Tuesday. Signed on a free after his release from West Bromwich Albion. Nearly 430 games in the top two divisions in his career. 285 at this level. He played in the Premier League for Blackpool and QPR and West Brom. Kieran Brown trying to find him there. He motored forward from the back. Coventry almost allowing him possession, and then he just gave it away. Now he's out of position. And Volks has had to drop back in at centre-half while Brown is coming back. He's back there now. Coventry have still got it. They're midway inside the Oxford half. And Cov have got a player down hurt. And Eccles, seeing that, puts it out of play so that Laddie Baudier can receive whatever treatment he needs.
Yeah, I think it's a bit of a coming together with Harris, and that started a couple of minutes ago earlier on in that play, and they're having a bit of to-do with each other. Harris went down. Now Laddie Baudier's gone down in a heap. It's one of those ones where it's difficult for the officials off the ball, especially when the ball's up the other side of the pitch.
As a football fan who's had an interesting journey as a fan myself, supporting a lower profile team, I fully understand that any opportunity comes your way, you've got to make the most of it. But singing, we're Oxford United, we're top of the league. 63 minutes into game two when 22 of the other teams in the division have only played one. Yeah, I would do it. Of course I would do it, but we'll see. But they are top of the league at the moment after that victory against Norwich last weekend. 4 points from their opening two games against Norwich and Coventry would constitute a really good return if they can hang on for the next 25 minutes. At least hang on. They might. The way that they've improved over the opening minutes of this second half, I think they can build on this and yet get more. Now, Laddie Baudier hasn't been receiving treatment. He's still not happy. He's inside the centre circle and he's getting back to his feet. But he's not going to have to leave the field because the Coventry medical staff didn't come on to administer any treatment for him. Just a reminder what's coming up. West Brom Leeds from the Championship tomorrow, 12:30 here on TalkSport 2. Also from the Championship, Sunderland Sheffield Wednesday, 12 o'clock here on TalkSport 2, Sunday lunchtime. And Bolton Wrexham, big game in League 1, 3 o'clock as part of an EFL double bill for you Sunday. Premier League action goes on right now over on TalkSport. Midway through the second half, Man United 0, Fulham 0 it remains. Newcastle Southampton here on TalkSport 2 tomorrow at 3. And game day live from Suffolk, Ipswich against Liverpool. 12:30 kickoff tomorrow on TalkSport. We've got it all covered for you. And then Monday night is Leicester Tottenham. So much like football for you. More than ever before and more than anyone else here on the TalkSport Network. Played 65 minutes here in the West Midlands tonight. Laddie Baudier able to continue, signalling over to the bench, seemingly that he's all right. Oxford on the edge of their own penalty area can play their way out from the back. Ellis Sims has done well, winning possession back, feeds Rodoni. Rodoni, the neat little 1-2 with Eccles. Rodoni able to turn in receiving that pass. Then Eccles goes to his right, gets it back from Van Aewijk. Rodoni wanted the ball in towards his feet. It swung in deeper instead towards Bidwell and headed away and out for a corner, which will be taken over on the Coventry left.
If Coventry have identified that as an Oxford United weakness, because that whipping ball to the back stick has certainly been used on many occasions tonight.
2-2 the score. And Coventry to take this latest set piece. It's their ninth corner to Oxford's one. Right footed in towards the near post. Looking for a near flick header, and it's cleared off the line. Just off the line. The near post flick was brilliant. And then coming in at the far post, it was so nearly turned home by Binks. And Coventry are inches away from a 3-2 lead.
It was ever so close. The Coventry City fans behind the goal, they were up. The Oxford United fans just to the right, I think, had head in their hands initially. It was really, really close, that one. But as you mentioned, Jim, it's a really well-worked corner. The fact that that flick on at the near post, it's finally worked. It's something you can tell they've been trying to do and hasn't quite come off. And they ghost in at the back stick, Binks, but fantastic moment. Body on the line to block by Oxford United.
Well, from a personal point of view, that would have been some week had he scored, because I've seen Dykesdale score his first goal in 130 games for Middlesbrough, and that would have been the first goal of Louis Binks' career, and he's played more than 100 games. So, probably could have retired. Here's Laddie Baudier towards Binks. Football completed. Seen them both score in the space of a week. Binks towards halfway. Long left-footed ball out towards the Coventry right, brilliantly brought down by Van Aewijk, firing it across, and the header is over the bar from Sims. Right, I beg your pardon. Coming at the far post, he just had to stretch. That meant that he couldn't quite keep it down. It's cleared the bar by a foot or so.
Yeah, it's one of them. It's hard to slow down in time because you're working that hard with that much pace to try and get into the right area, and to slow down quickly so you can get the right positioning on the ball is a very difficult skill. But I love that cross-field ball. Van Aewijk as well, the fact that he doesn't think about it, he's got that quality just to put it across, he doesn't panic. It's a really well-worked passage of play.
Adji Wright retreating this time in defensive duty, has fouled his man. It's going to be a free kick that will be taken by Oxford and taken by Volks out to the right-hand side. There's the substitute, El Mazzouni, receiving the ball in the midfield. And then being in the right place to receive Moore's pass. Looks like there's some action on the Coventry bench. Mark Robbins has kept his powder dry into the final quarter of the game, but is going to be making a change. And Brandon Thomas Asante is going to be coming on for his home debut after his move from West Bromwich Albion very shortly. Bennett back to his goalkeeper. Oxford playing out from Cumming to Moore and now to El Mazzouni. He's given it away with a hurried pass. Coventry winning it back. Little reverse ball intended by Wright. Couldn't get it in towards Sims. A few murmurs of discontent from the Sky Blues fans. Oxford bring it forward, but Goodrum can't find a way past Van Aewijk. Brannigan has it now in the midfield with 69 gone at 2-2.
There's them groans as well because the initial touch was wonderful by Wright, the way that he brought it down. And I can see what he's trying to do, put that reverse ball in. But I think that run actually opened up an opportunity where he could have touched it, taken another one forward and then tried to hit an opportunity from the edge of the box.
Oxford work it long, too long, straight through the penalty area. No chance for Harris getting on the end of that, and it goes out of play for a goal kick. So the change will be made, and Thomas Asante is going to come on for Sims, who scored 8 goals in his last 7 games here, but he hasn't really had an opportunity tonight. And Thomas Asante replaces him. Once had a spell on loan in the National League South with Oxford City. Now comes on against Oxford United after his £2.5 million move from West Brom. 12 goals for the Baggies last season. And he's on the Ghanaian international for his home debut. And he'll play through the middle. No change in the formation. Sakamoto, one of the smaller men on the pitch, chasing a high ball that was whipped in from the Coventry left. And it's gone out of play. And it'll be a throw which will be taken on the Oxford left. No, it's gone out of play. It's a goal kick which will be taken away to our right-hand side by Oxford's Jamie Cumming.
I think Thomas Asante, for me, needs to impose himself on the game a little bit more than Ellis Sims did. He had that really good opportunity in the first half where he just couldn't sort his feet out quick enough and get his stride pattern right to get on the end of the ball. But aside from that, he's been a bit of a passenger in the game. And for all the possession that Coventry City have had and opportunity in wide areas, he probably needs to be doing a little bit more to get on the end of the ball. Yes, you can blame the service at times, but I just think he's been far too quiet, Ellis Sims.
Right playing it in again, looking for Sakamoto. Bennett heads that one away and out for a corner. So the corner count up into double figures, still 0-0 between Manchester United and Fulham. 65% possession for United, but only 4 shots on target through 73 minutes there. Continues for you live right now over on TalkSport. Coventry are going to be making another change with Mason Clark set to be introduced. But after this corner, which will be taken on the Coventry right by Radoni. Can they get the near post flick this time? They can't. They went deeper. It's punch clear. Right-footed effort from Torp through a crowd. It was going wide. Kept back in because of so many pairs of legs in there. It's bound to hit somebody. It actually hit a Coventry player in an offside position. At one end of the ground here, as we look away to our right, to the end that Coventry are attacking, there is a massive scoreboard with the badges of Coventry and Oxford and a sky blue background and 2-2 with the cloth as well. And standing in front of that scoreboard, the back row of the home end, there are 6 or 7 supporters. So just blocking the view of the light blue at the bottom of that screen. And you can just see their silhouettes, but you can see how they're nervously changing their weight from one foot to another. The Coventry fans are very tense with 17 minutes to go because they will feel this is a game that they should have had wrapped up by now. But it's very much in the balance, Courtney Sweetman-Kirk, as the Sky Blues bring on Mason Clark for Sakamoto.
Yeah, should have been and could have been out of sight. It's as simple as that for the opportunities that they've had. And as I mentioned, that Ellis Sims miss, for example, is a really good opportunity that's gone begging, especially the possession and the quality of the possession that they've had in wide areas. The service has had to be better in the box as well. And it's one of those where it's, you know, you're 2-1 up, you feel good, you feel positive, you're having lots of the ball. Next thing you know, it's a bit of a mishap in the box. It's a good diving header, a touch that you're not expecting, and it's 2-2. And now there is such a nervousness around the CBS where, in the first half, it was absolutely rocking, wasn't it?
There to be one for either side. 2-2 with 17 minutes to go here on TalkSport 2. Van Aewijk plays the ball back. Eccles gives him a return pass. Coming in off the right flank. Played in. Good touch by Mason Clark. Right-footed ball inside the penalty area. That one is easily cleared by Volks. He'll come down for Van Aywijk again. And the Dutchman goes back for John Ladibodier. Ladibodier, the Jamaican international who had three games for his country at the Copa America over the summer. High ball in from Bidwell, sails straight over the goal and out for a goal kick. Going to be taken away to the right-hand side. Ephraim Mason-Clark, a player that Coventry actually signed back in February, but they loaned him straight back to Peterborough, where he scored 19 goals last season. He's on for his home debut. No previous experience at this level, but a real box of tricks and an unpredictability as well.
Yeah, and I think he's a player from seeing him that can make this step up. As you say, he's got that unpredictability, so some of that's good at this level, some of that will need to be tamed a little bit, but certainly the ability that he has on the ball is one of the best I've seen in League One, and I do think, given the right coaching and the right environment, which you will expect under Mark Robbins, that he will be able to make the step up to the Championship.
The ball's headed on by Wright and chased by Thomas Asante. But he couldn't keep it in, and it's gone out for a goal kick, which will be taken by Cumming, who's not indulging in time-wasting tactics per se, but he is he's not racing to pick up a loose ball when it goes out of play for a goal kick. And as I often say, that very much an observation, not a criticism, because I would want my goalkeeper in those situations to be doing exactly that. But he's just managing the game well. He's waving everybody upfield. Now he will drive it forward, right-footed, over halfway, where players from both sides came to meet the ball and neither made contact. Van Aywijk can. He'll run into space. Ladibodier goes back for his goalkeeper. And it's cleared by Dovin out to the far touchline for Bidwell. Bidwell cushions ahead of through the midfield. Torp loses out, though, to Volks, who played it straight into his teammate. Thomas Asante wins it back. Torp stayed down injured for the time being for Coventry. Play goes on with Hadji Wright. Left-hand side of the penalty area. Pulled back towards Eccles, but he missed him. Torp is back on his feet. Oxford play it forward. Harris has made a run from inside his own half. And he's only got Ladibodier between him and goal. Coventry getting bodies back. And Ladibodier defended it really well. Couldn't stop Harris getting a shot in, but he was so close to him that the ball was bound to hit him, and it cleared out for a throw.
What I like about Oxford United at the minute is they've got a little bit more composure about themselves. Even when Coventry City are attacking and they've got the ball, they're quite set in their shape, and I feel like they know exactly what they're doing in terms of they're quite happy now to sit into more of a mid-block, probably, let's say, a low block, and play on the transition, play on the counter, and they're quite happy with that. Just looking over to my right-hand side as well, and Louis Sibley is about to come on, young player with a good amount of pace. So in terms of playing on the transition, he will certainly help that. Seen him for a few years, and when he came through at Derby, he's got a good finish on him as well. So I think sort of the perfect type of player to bring on in this situation.
Yeah, and they scored a hat-trick in the Championship for Derby before he turned 19. Maybe didn't quite hit the heights that were anticipated after that extraordinary start. I think that was only the second league start of his career. But he's going to come on here. He's only 22 now, and he's got a lot of miles on the clock for someone that age. This is his 175th career appearance, and it comes as he replaces Tyler Goodrum. So Goodrum leaves the field, and Louis Sibley, who signed from Derby in the summer, is on to replace him. You're not missing anything, because Coventry still have a player down her inside their own penalty area. I must admit, the medical staff are obscuring the view of who it is. I'm just looking around the rest of the team to try and ascertain who isn't there. I think it is Torp. Torp, the man that is receiving the treatment. And that's a byproduct, I think, of that heavy challenge on halfway. About 60 seconds before he went down here, went down to the next phase of play, knowing that just needed some help to be administered. So he's going to be off the field for 30 seconds. As he makes his way over towards the far touchline. So Oxford temporarily, with a numerical advantage. And they made the change. Sibley, his blonde hair, waiting on the edge of the penalty area. He's come on to replace Goodrum. So a throw to be taken over on the Oxford right-hand side by Volks. Coventry have struggled to deal with second phases from set-piece is that Oxford have had in. They get the first ball away easily enough. Now Thomas Asante will be able to chase and lead a counter-attack until a brilliant challenge comes in on him. It was El Mazzouni that won it back, actually twice, because Thomas Asante then got back to his feet and had another go at trying to play the ball forward, and El Mazzouni flicked it away from him that time as well. And Coventry have Torp coming back on now, so they're back up to 11. 2-2 with 11 minutes to go, Courtney.
Yeah, it's a vital challenge as well, because the fact that Coventry City had two players off the ball advancing as well. So it's a very good challenge at an important time by El Mazzouni.
Casey Palmer, another one of the Coventry players who scored at home to Oxford in the Cup last season, is going to be coming on next. Sibley, first introduction is for him to play the ball back towards Joe Bennett. Sibley replacing Goodrum. He's a much taller man, more well built than the man that he's replaced. That was a very hefty challenge coming in on Oxford's Mark Harris. An apology will suffice from Laddie Baudier. Referee David Coote not producing a card for that. Brannigan will come across to take the free kick, and Coventry will actually make a double change. Bidwell off and De Silva on to replace him. And Casey Palmer is going to come on as well. So it's a straight swap at left back. And Palmer's going to come on to replace Torp. They're not going to take any chances with Torp after that injury that he picked up a few minutes ago. So Palmer for Torp and De Silva for Bidwell. And that's Coventry's changes made. The third and final opportunity for them to rotate the pack. Vaux to take a free kick for Oxford. Coventry are keeping an artificially high line, which is 11, 12 yards outside their own penalty area. And the free kick is being taken from a similar distance inside their half. Good reverse ball, actually, from the free kick from Vaux for Sibley. Sibley trying to take on Van Aewijk. Can't win a corner. Van Aewijk does well, controls it, flicks it up with his thigh, punts it away. Palmer is in there with a challenge with Vaux, which he lost. Brown with a good reverse ball. Sibley through the six-yard box, tipped away by the goalkeeper from Harris, and had Dovin not got a touch, then it would have been a tap-in for Harris to make it 3-2 to Oxford. And now Mason Clark is fouled as Coventry bring it forward. They've taken the free kick instantly. Eccles swings it wide out towards the far touchline. Right inside the penalty. Palmer on the half volley, way over the bar.
It's a difficult opportunity for Palmer, although I think he should be doing better. You're right, Jim, it's on the half volley. Just before it gets to him, it bounces up, and that's when it does get quite awkward. You've got to do everything you can to try and get your knee and your hip over the ball to keep it down so it stays under the bar. Maybe if he'd been on for a little bit longer, that might have had a different outcome, because he's just come on the pitch, barely had a touch. It might even be his first touch, and to try and put that one in the back of the net is a difficult skill.
2-2, 8 minutes to go. Now the ball out of play for an Oxford throw over on the far touchline. Well, they've certainly hung in there. They haven't known when they've been beaten, and they were on the ropes at times, particularly in the first half. There's Buckingham making the slight tactical switches that were necessary, seeing where the problems were. And sticking a thumb in the dike, so to speak.
Yeah, and they're going to need that in abundance through the season, Oxford United, but they've dusted themselves down. They've not felt sorry for themselves. They've found a way, albeit a little bit, you know, peculiar to get themselves back in the game, but it doesn't matter. All that matters is that big scoreboard to our right that says 2-2.
Van Aewijk with it for Coventry, ball in towards the near post, and that's caught by Cumming. You know, over the last 12 years, only two promoted sides have won their first two games in the Championship. Ipswich did it last season, Charlton did it 5 years ago. And Oxford will be eyeing up the remaining 7 minutes here and hoping that they might be able to add their name to that particular list. In their first away game at this level for 25 years, their last one, a 0-0 draw at high-flying Bradford back in 1999, which did nothing for the Bantams' promotion chase that year. Ball played forward by Oxford through the midfield, and it drifts through towards Dovin. Really important touch from him, about 90 seconds ago, to steer the ball out of Harris's path. Eccles misplaces the pass. It's not that Coventry are panicking, far from it, but it's just a little a ragged edge to some of their passing game in midfield as they look a little bit tired physically and maybe mentally as well with the pressure being on their shoulders. They're not able to play the same kind of flamboyant football that lit up times of the first half.
And I think Oxford have got their shape a little bit better. The fact that they'll drop in now, that Sibley and Phillips, for example, are joining Harris up there just to make sure he's got a little bit of support when they're pressing from the front, and it worked there. And going forward, they've got to do the same in terms of when they get on the ball, add more bodies to the attack. You see now it's a 4-4-2 out of possession with Phillips joining Harris.
Laddie Bodier sends a long ball out towards De Silva on the Coventry left. It's headed away from him by El Mazzouni. A throw that Coventry take and work back for Binks. 6 to go. 2-2 the scoreline. Laddie Bodier to Van Ewijk. Van Ewijk is 5 yards inside Oxford territory. Laddie Bodier squeezes the ball forward. Eccles does well, wins the seconds. Now an opportunity for Mason Clark. Right footed inside the penalty area, half cleared. Thomas Asante couldn't pick it up. Oxford bring it away. It's Sibley that is going to be able to get it forward. And he switches play quickly out towards Phillips. Now Matt Phillips, the Oxford winger, coming in off the right hand touchline. Just checks inside. Sibley in space on the far side, as far as Phillips is looking, which is the Oxford left. He's worked it back instead for Bennett. Bennett back inside his own half. Brown deeper inside his own half. Back to his goalkeeper. Cumming knocks it out towards the far touchline. And Long heads it on for El Mazzouni. 5 to go at 2-2. 0-0 still at Old Trafford. But Manchester United putting late pressure on there. Here's Casey Palmer. Palmer out towards the left. Jay De Silva coming forward. De Silva in off the left-hand touchline. Back for Palmer. Palmer coming forward towards the edge of the Oxford penalty area. Trying to slip the ball in. He's managed it for Wright. Keeps his feet. Round one challenge. Not round the second. Elliot Moore slides in. Puts it out of play for another Coventry corner.
Too much. Simple as that. Hadji Wright's been really good tonight down that left-hand side. But hands aloft in the air. Radoni. And I think it was Thomas Asante. That needed to go across far quicker than it did.
At Old Trafford, Manchester United 1, Fulham 0. Looks like an 87th minute winner from Joshua Zirkzee on his debut. It's live for you right now over on TalkSport. 4 to go here. In comes the corner. Deep towards the far post where nobody had made a run for Coventry. Eccles is going to be able to keep it in and recycle it on the right-hand touchline. Ends up winning a throw is all he could do, really. Brannigan came across to stop the ball back for Van Ewijk. Throw taken quickly back for Laddie Bodier. Zirkzee goal with a Garnacho assist. Manchester United 1, Fulham 0. 2-2 in this one. Radoni on the Coventry left. Ball that was just a little bit too low as he fired it in towards the near post, and Long heads it away. Out towards Casey Palmer. Palmer can come forward. Cleared by him. Eccles. Played by Eccles towards Binks. Binks to Radoni. Radoni to De Silva. Oxford still keeping a tight shape behind the ball. They're going to be bringing Dane Scarlett on for his debut of the next break in play. Binks will play it forward again. He's come closer than anyone to putting either side 3-2 up. High ball inside the penalty area here for Mason Clark. It was over hit. He's done really well to keep it alive. Van Ewijk then drilled it in. Hit and hope, but with real ferocity inside the box, and that one is clear. Coventry can come forward again with Eccles. He's played it back for Mason Clark. Mason Clark to Casey Palmer. Left-footed, tried a little reverse ball. It's right, and it's saved, and it's Mason Clark, and he's possibly hit the outside of the post. And Oxford get it away. Coventry bring it forward. That had to go in. And Ephraim Mason-Clark missed it. Palmer now for Coventry. Towards the edge of the penalty area and Oxford clear. Mark Robbins has scored a stack of goals in his career. Looks as though he can't believe what he's just seen. Radoni on the edge of the centre circle. To Laddie Bodier. It's woken the crowd up though from their nervous torpor. The support here has been magnificent. It's just died in the last 10 minutes or so. Binks from distance, well worth a hit from 30 yards. Keeper dives to his right, palms it clear. Back it comes in. Moore heads that one away. Palmer can't pick it up on the edge of the area. All of a sudden, it is all Coventry.
Oh, there's so much going on there. Mason Clark, I think he's so thoughtful about hitting the target that he doesn't just think about scoring the goal, if that makes the sense.
In comes the next cross over Mason Clark and goes out of play for a throw down by the corner flag to Oxford.
And it's one of those where the goal's gaping. I don't know whether it's a little bit in front of him. And as I say, instead of really putting your foot through it and wanting to make sure you hit the back of the net, I think he's too concerned about hitting the target. But Coventry City putting all the pressure on. The fans to our right are up and down off the seats. The quads are going to be burning them when they get home, because it's really edge of the seat stuff at the moment.
Mark Harris comes off for Oxford. Dane Scarlett, who signed on loan from Tottenham this week, a player that has made 6 Premier League appearances and a loan spell at Ipswich last season, where he just came off the bench, 12 substitute appearances for Ipswich without scoring a goal. He's coming on for just a brief Oxford debut here. 30 seconds plus stoppage time to go. It's going to be a fair bit of time to be added on. There could be 5 minutes. All Coventry at the moment. Binks, who could have had 2 tonight, for all the fact he's never scored a senior goal in his career. He's had one kicked off the line and then he's tested the goalkeeper from range.
Yeah, and the goalkeeper does well, because then it goes out to safety, it goes out to the side. I think it was Hadji Wright that was bearing down, waiting for that little tap in his all good forward should do, following the ball in, but the goalkeeper coming does really well.
Well, I said 5, it is 7 extra minutes. Ball played over the top by Eccles. Anybody that saw Coventry's extraordinary FA Cup run last year will know that they're a side built for extra time and stoppage time. Eccles, back to his goalkeeper. 2-2, 17 shots to 8 in Coventry's favour. But of the 17, only 5 have been on target, and that is certainly something that will frustrate Mark Robbins. Aiming for his 150th Coventry win tonight, he will feel that it should have come. And it might yet, of course, but they've got work to do. Now, the 7 extra minutes are going to be extended further, because there's been a clash of heads here between Hadji Wright and Kieran Brown. I think Wright's come off the worst of the two. Both players are just being lent over now by referee Coote. And actually, good to see they're getting back to their feet straight away, and he's happy that there's no need for any concussion checks or anything. And so play will resume with only a brief hiatus. 6 minutes to stoppage time to go, Courtney. 2-2. It's been a great game.
Yeah, it's been fantastic. It's really been end-to-end at times. Coventry City were by far the better team in the first half. But this second half, it's been very topsy-turvy. Not sure which way it's going. I mean, it wouldn't surprise me if there's a goal left in it. Don't tell me ask me for which side, because I've not got a clue, quite frankly, how up and down this second half has been.
Dane Scarlett's offside. And it's a free kick which will be taken by Coventry. They can't take it from where they want to, though, because they still nicked a few yards. And Laddie Baudier for Radoni, whose influence hasn't necessarily been on the wane, but they've dealt with him much better in the second half, Oxford, than they did in the first, where he was brilliant. Van Aywijk chasing, right-hand side of the penalty area. Got there first. No foul. It's a corner. And there were claims for a handball. The referee immediately threw his arms across his body to say no, but it is a corner to Coventry which Radoni will take.
Yeah, I think that was more from the fans behind the goal in hope more than expectation. I looked at the reaction of the players and certainly wasn't for a handball.
2-2 in stoppage time, but still 4 minutes of stoppage time to go. Corner very deep from Radoni. Excellent header away came from Moore. But Oxford have still got more defensive work to do, because that's gone out of play for another corner. One of the lucky number 13. Now that Torp's gone off, Radoni's taken the corners from both sides. He gets a big ovation from the Sky Blues fans over on that far touchline as he trots over to take this. 6 Sky Blue shirted players inside that penalty area for Radoni to try and hit. 3 make runs in towards the near post, looking for a flick on. Ball wasn't quite good enough, and it's clear. Van Aywijk back out towards Radoni. Coventry looking for a stoppage time winner here. Rodoni twisting and turning, can't find a way through, but he hasn't lost possession. Then very cleverly works it back for De Silva. Coventry will come again with Eccles. Eccles outside the area, let's fly! And it's comfortable for the goalkeeper, just went right along the ground. And Cumming could get his hands behind it. And Oxford getting ever closer to a valuable point that will have them top of the league tonight.
Yeah, and it can be funny as well how a draw can feel like a win. And it will do for Oxford United if they see this out, the fact that they've come from behind and they've been under pressure for so much of the game, but the change in the shape, little tweaks in the tactical nature of the game, the way that they've really dug in, it'll feel like a massive point for them if they manage to hold on.
Mason Clark fouled. Manchester United have won. They've beaten Fulham 1-0 with that 87th minute winner from Xerxes on his debut. He came on the hour mark. A game that Mazraoui started. De Ligt came on for his debut off the bench. Phillips for Oxford, bringing it forward. High ball over the top here. And out comes the Coventry goalkeeper. Just had to make sure the lines of communication were right there between Dovin and Laddie Baudière. I think Laddie Baudière is making the point that Dovin should have stayed back there and allowed him to head it back to him. Because as he was, Dovin had to race outside his penalty area and clear. He's put it out of play for a throw, which of course gives Oxford the opportunity to run a few more seconds off the clock. 2.5 minutes of the seven extra still to be played. Throw which Joe Bennett is going to take. Just tiptoeing forward. Teddy clear. And then volleyed further forward by Mason Clark. High header from Moore. Oh, Moore's got some backpedalling to do. He's lost it. Hadji Wright is in to win it for Coventry. Round the goalkeeper. 3-2. And they deserve it. Rapturous acclaim greets the Hadji Wright goal. Elliot Moore's had an excellent night tonight at the heart of the Oxford defence, but he was done for pace. Wright racing through. Goal side of Moore, drew the goalkeeper, threatened to shoot, calmly flicked the ball to his left. The man that started the scoring is going to end it. Hadji Wright with the winner for the Sky Blues. Coventry 3, Oxford 2.
Talk about composure. Hadji Wright has got so much time to think about this, by the way. Oxford United will be absolutely devastated because it's their error. But then Hadji Wright is on his front foot, he's ready to pounce on the mistake. He's got more bearing down on him as well. Takes him out with that little touch to the right-hand side. Goes round Cumming, sells in for a hot dog, and then just places it in the back of the net. What a composed finish that is.
19 goals last season, 2 in 2 this season. It is a brilliant piece of attacking play. As soon as he was through, you never sensed that he was going to miss it. So good in front of goal. Hadji Wright, right. Seeing the Coventry City fans. They lead it 3-2 with about a minute and a half to go. Now off the ball, Moore and Mason Clark both get involved. That looks as though it was 6 of 1 and half a dozen of the other, but the referee has given Oxford a free kick for that. And the yellow shirts will come forward. The 7 minutes are up, but the celebration for the goal is going to add at least another 30, 45 seconds on. That's notwithstanding the law change. So plenty of time for this free kick yet for Oxford. Coventry defending with a high line. Oxford looking for another equaliser. Their third of the night. They're 3-2 down. Ball is headed away. Headed away well by Binks. Out towards the far touchline. Long for Oxford. Loses out to throw to Coventry, and they'll be able to see it over the line from there.
I absolutely love that. Hadji Wright has celebrated that nearly as much as the goal that he's just scored. I've got a lot of time for that.
Coventry City fans in fine voice, and they will be able to bring the ball forward, and the counter attack is on. You know they might win it 4-2, because here is Thomas Asante for Mason Clark. Keeps his feet, and his left-footed effort is deflected over the bar. No time to take the corner. It's a massive Sky Blue roar anymore that greets the full-time whistle. They've got it done by the odd goal in five, but they left it to the 96th minute to win it. Another magnificent advert for the EFL here on TalkSport 2.
Well, they made hard work of it, but it was great for us to watch. It was a brilliant game. So many thrills and spills. Hadji right at the end was so composed. And as you mentioned, Jim, I had the same feeling. As soon as he went through, you never felt like he was going to miss it. He's had a really good game. And Oxford United, though, they are going to be absolutely gutted. On the balance of play, did they deserve to win? Probably not. But the fact that they got themselves back in the game, there was only a couple of minutes. All they had to do was stand firm. And more than that is the fact that their error led to that goal. But I've seen enough from Oxford United tonight to think that they'll be all right in the Championship, not necessarily by their play, but in terms of how they've really dug in their togetherness. And they've got a little bit of something in that team, I think.
Yeah, they go to Blackburn next, and then Preston and Stoke at home after that. It's their home form that really is probably going to be pivotal in whether they do finish the right or wrong side of the dotted line. For what it's worth, I thought that they showed plenty of spirit and fight tonight, and their qualities. They know they're not going to be able to out football sides week in, week out, but they've got the qualities that will stand them in good stead, I think, for the fight ahead. But what about Cov? Because they could have been out of sight. They beat Oxford 6-2 in the Cup here last season. They could have beaten them 6-2 again tonight. Might have been even more emphatic than that. But the fact that they left it so late to be able to get over the line, that will probably tomorrow morning cause Mark Robbins a little bit of concern.
Yeah, maybe even more quickly than that. Don't get me wrong, he'll be happy for the win. And these fans will be absolutely buzzing because they've seen the last minute winner. But actually, when you take a step back from it and analyse it, you're completely right. It shouldn't have been as difficult as it was for them. The amount of chances they created, but the quality of the chances as well. And they'll be the things that Mark Robbins will pick up on, especially on the back of the first Championship game that he wasn't happy with. So there's a lot more to like about this performance, but there's still maybe a few alarm bells where they're not finishing chances where they should be. But for the moment, let these players enjoy that last minute winner, because trust me, there is not a better feeling in football.
Well, as a Torquay fan, I'll take your word for that. The Coventry fans delighting in what they've seen. The Oxford fans stayed to the end. Massive ovation for their team as well. Which gives you an illustration, really, the reaction of both sets of fans about the quality of the game, how exciting it was, but also how they felt their teams performed. Really, really good start to the EFL weekend, which continues tomorrow here on TalkSport 2 with Leeds' trip to West Brom, Sunderland against Sheffield Wednesday, Sunday lunchtime at 12, Bolton Wrexham in League 1 at 3. They're all EFL games here on TalkSport 2 over the course of the weekend. Also here on TalkSport 2 tomorrow afternoon from the Premier League, Newcastle at home to newly promoted Southampton, and Ipswich's first game back in the Premier League at home to Liverpool. 12:30 kickoff at Portland Road. Build-up starts with Game Day Live at 11 tomorrow. My thanks to Courtney Sweetman-Kirk, great company, for a great game over on TalkSport very shortly. The Sports Bar weekend with Majestic and Jermaine Pennant. Taking your calls on tonight's action, Manchester United's win over Fulham and their performance will certainly be leading the agenda. The guys will also be looking ahead to all of the weekend's football as well. Number to dial 03717 223 344, and you can also send them a WhatsApp voice note with your reaction to the very same number. Coming next on TalkSport 2, it's live PGA Tour golf with action from the second round of the FedEx and Jude Championship from Memphis, Tennessee. But we'll leave you from the West Midlands, where it ended all right on the night for Coventry. Good night. At Vodafone.